tales for dark nights.
Cool air. You ask me to explain why I am afraid of a draft of cool air, why I shiver more than others upon entering a cold room, and seem nauseated and repelled when the chill of evening creeps through the heat of a mild autumn day. There are those who say I respond to cold as others do to a bad odor, and I am the last to deny the impression. What I will do is to relate the most horrible circumstance I ever encountered, and leave it up to you to judge whether or not this forms a suitable explanation of my peculiarity. It is a mistake to fancy that horror is associated inextricably with darkness, silence, and solitude. I found it in the glare of mid-afternoon, in the clangor of a metropolis, and in the teeming midst of a shabby and commonplace rooming house with a prosaic landlady and two stalwart men by my side. In the spring of 1923, I had secured some dreary and unprofitable magazine work in the city of New York, and being unable to pay any substantial rent, began drifting from one cheap boarding establishment to another in search of a room that might combine the qualities of decent cleanliness, endurable furnishings, and very reasonable price. It soon developed that I had only a choice between different evils, but after a time, I came upon a house in West 14th Street, which disgusted me much less than the others I had sampled. The place was a four-story mansion of brownstone, dating apparently from the late 40s, and fitted with woodwork and marble whose stained and sullied splendor argued a descent from high levels of tasteful opulence. In the rooms, large and lofty and decorated with impossible paper and ridiculously ornate stucco cornices, there lingered a depressing mustiness and hint of obscure cookery. But the floors were clean, the linen tolerably regular, and the hot water not too often cold or turned off, so that I came to regard it as at least a bearable place to hibernate till one might really live again. The landlady, a slatternly, almost bearded Spanish woman named Herrero, did not annoy me with gossip or with criticisms of the late burning electric light in my third floor front hall room, and my fellow lodgers were as quiet and uncommunicative as one might desire, being mostly Spaniards, a little above the coarsest and crudest grade. Only the din of streetcars in the thoroughfare below proved a serious annoyance. I'd been there about 3 weeks when the first odd incident occurred. One evening, at about 8, I heard a spattering on the floor and became suddenly aware that I had been smelling the pungent odor of ammonia for some time. Looking about, I saw that the ceiling was wet and dripping, the soaking apparently proceeding from a corner of the side toward the street. Anxious to stop the matter at its source, I hastened to the basement to tell the landlady and was assured by her that the trouble would quickly be set right. "Dr. Munoz," she cried as she rushed upstairs ahead of me. "He have spilled his chemicals. He is too sick for doctor himself, sicker and sicker all the time. But he will not have to have no other for help. He is very queer in his sickness. All day he take funny-smelling baths, and he cannot get excite or warm. All his own housework he do, his little room are full of bottles and machines, and he do not work as doctor. But he was great once, my father in Barcelona have hear of him, and only just now he fix an arm of a plumber that got hurt of sudden. He never go out, only on roof, and my boy Esteban, he bring him his food and laundry and medicines and chemicals. My God, the salammoniac that man use for keep him cool." Mrs. Herrero disappeared up the staircase to the fourth floor, and I returned to my room. The ammonia ceased to drip, and as I cleaned up what had spilled and opened the window for air, I heard the landlady's heavy footsteps above me. Dr. Munoz, I had never heard, save for certain sounds as of some gasoline-driven mechanism, since his step was soft and gentle. I wondered for a moment what the strange affliction of this man might be, and whether his obstinate refusal of outside aid were not the result of a rather baseless eccentricity. There is, I reflected tritely, an infinite deal of pathos in the state of an eminent person who has come down in the world. I may never have known Dr. Munoz had it not been for the heart attack that suddenly seized me one afternoon as I sat writing in my room. Physicians had told me of the danger of those spells, and I knew that there was no time to be lost, so remembering what the landlady had said about the invalid's help of an injured workman, I dragged myself upstairs and knocked feebly at the door above mine. The knock was answered in good English by a curious voice some distance to the right, asking my name and business, and these things being stated, there came an opening of the door next to the one I had sought. A cool rush of air greeted me, and though the day was one of the hottest of late June, I shivered as I crossed the threshold into a large apartment whose rich and tasteful decoration surprised me in this nest of squalor and seediness. A folding couch now filled its diurnal role of sofa, and the mahogany furniture, sumptuous hangings, old paintings, and mellow bookshelves all bespoke a gentleman's study rather than a boarding-house room. I now saw that the hall room above mine, the lethal room of bottles and machines, which Mrs. Herrero had mentioned, was merely the laboratory of the doctor, and that his main living quarters lay in the spacious adjoining room, whose convenient alcoves and large contiguous bathroom permitted him to hide all dressers and obtrusively utilitarian devices. Dr. Munoz most certainly was a man of birth, cultivation, and discrimination. The figure before me was short but exquisitely proportioned, and clad in somewhat formal dress of perfect cut and fit. A hybrid face of masterful, though not arrogant, expression was adorned by a short, iron-gray full beard, and an old-fashioned pince-nez shielded the full, dark eyes and surmounted an aquiline nose which gave a Moorish touch to a physiognomy otherwise dominantly Celtiberian. Thick, well-trimmed hair that argued the punctual calls of a barber was parted gracefully above a high forehead, and the whole picture was one of striking intelligence and superior blood and breathing. Nevertheless, as I saw Dr. Munoz in that blast of cool air, I felt a repugnance which nothing in his aspect could justify. Only his lividly inclined complexion and coldness of touch could have afforded a physical basis for this feeling, and even these things should have been excusable considering the man's known invalidism. It might, too, have been the singular cold that alienated me, for such chilliness was abnormal on so hot a day, and the abnormal always excites aversion, distrust, and fear. But repugnance was soon forgotten in admiration, for the strange physician's extreme skill at once became manifest, despite the ice coldness and shakiness of his bloodless-looking hands. He clearly understood my needs at a glance, and ministered to them with a master's deftness, the while reassuring me, in a finely modulated though oddly hollow and timberless voice, that he was the bitterest of sworn enemies to death, and had sunk his fortune and lost all his friends in a lifetime of bizarre experiment devoted to its bafflement and extirpation. Something of a benevolent fanatic seemed to arise in him, and he rambled on almost garrulously as he sounded on my chest and mixed a suitable draught of drugs fetched from the smaller laboratory room. Evidently he found the society of a well-born man a rare novelty in this dingy environment, and was moved to unaccustomed speech as memories of better days surged over him. His voice, if queer, was at least soothing, and I could not perceive that he breathed as the fluent sentences rolled urbanly out. He sought to distract my mind from my own seizure by speaking of his theories and experiments, And I remember his tactfully consoling me about my weak heart by insisting that will and consciousness are stronger than organic life itself. So that if a bodily frame be but originally healthy and carefully preserved, it may, through a scientific enhancement of these qualities, retain a kind of nervous animation despite the most serious impairments, defects, or even absences in the battery of specific organs. He might, he half-jestingly said, someday teach me to live, or at least to possess some kind of conscious existence without any heart at all. For his part, he was afflicted with a complication of maladies, requiring a very rare, exact regimen which included constant cold. Any marked rise in temperature might, if prolonged, affect him fatally, and the frigidity of his habitation, some 55 or 56 degrees Fahrenheit, was maintained by an absorption system of ammonia cooling, the gasoline engine of whose pumps I had often heard in my own room below. Relieved of my seizure in a marvelously short while, I left the shivering place a disciple and devotee of the gifted recluse. After that, I paid him frequent, overcoated calls, listening while he told of secret researches and almost ghastly results, and trembling a bit when I examined the unconventional and astonishingly ancient forms on his shelves. I was, eventually, I may add, almost cured of my diseases for all time by his skillful ministrations. It seemed that he did not scorn the incantations of medievalists, since he believed these cryptic formulae to contain rare psychological stimuli which might conceivably have singular effects on the substance of a nervous system from which organic pulsations had fled. I was touched by his account of the middle-aged Dr. Torres of Valencia, who had shared his earlier experiments and nursed him through the great illnesses of 18 years before, hence his present disorders proceeded. No sooner had the venerable practitioner saved his colleague than he himself succumbed to the grim enemy he had fought. Perhaps the strain had been too great, for Dr. Munoz made it whisperingly clear, though not in detail, that the methods of healing had been most extraordinary, involving scenes and processes not welcomed by elderly and conservative Galens. As the weeks passed, I observed with regret that my new friend was indeed slowly but unmistakably losing ground physically, as Mrs. Herrero had suggested. The livid aspect of his countenance was intensified. His voice became more hollow and indistinct. His muscular motions were less perfectly coordinated, and his mind and will displayed less resilience and initiative. Of this sad change he seemed by no means unaware, and little by little his expression and conversation both took on a gruesome irony which restored in me something of the subtle repulsion I had originally felt. He developed strange caprices, acquiring a fondness for exotic spices and Egyptian incense till his room smelled like a vault of a sepulchred pharaoh in the Valley of the Kings. At the same time, his demands for cold air increased, and with my aid, he amplified the ammonia piping of his room and modified the pumps and feed of his refrigerating machine till he could keep the temperature as low as 34 degrees or 40 degrees, and eventually even 28 degrees, the bathroom and laboratory, of course, being less chilled, in order that water might not freeze and that chemical processes might not be impeded. The tenant adjoining him complained of the icy air from around the connecting door, so I helped him fit heavy hangings to obviate the difficulty. A kind of growing horror, the odor and morbid cast, seemed to possess him. He talked of death incessantly, but laughed hollowly when such things as burial and funeral arrangements were gently suggested. All in all, he became a disconcerting and even gruesome companion. Yet, in my gratitude for his healing, I could not well abandon him to the strangers around him, and was careful to dust his room and attend to his needs each day, muffled in a heavy ulster which I bought especially for the purpose. I likewise did much of his shopping and gasped in bafflement at some of the chemicals he ordered from druggists and laboratory supply houses. An increasing and unexplained atmosphere of panic seemed to rise around his apartment. The whole house, as I have said, had a musty odor, but the smell in his room was worse, and in spite of all the spices and incense, and the pungent chemicals of the now incessant baths which he insisted on taking unaided. I perceived that it must be connected with his ailment, and I shuddered when I reflected on what ailment might be. Mrs. Herrero crossed herself when she looked at him and gave him up unreservedly to me, not even letting her son Esteban continue to run errands for him. When I suggested other physicians, the sufferer would fly into as much of a rage as he seemed to dare to entertain. He evidently feared the physical effect of violent emotion, yet his will and driving force waxed rather than waned, and he refused to be confined to his bed. The lassitude of his earlier ill days gave place to a return of his fiery purpose, so that he seemed about to hurl defiance at the death demon, even as that ancient enemy seized him. The pretense of eating, always curiously like a formality with him, he virtually abandoned, and mental power alone appeared to keep him from total collapse. He acquired a habit of writing long documents of some sort, which he carefully sealed and filled with injunctions that I transmit them after his death to certain persons who he named, for the most part lettered East Indians, but included a once celebrated French physician, now generally thought dead, and about whom the most inconceivable things had been whispered. As it happened, I burned all these papers, undelivered and unopened. His aspect and voice became utterly frightful, and his presence almost unbearable. One September day, an unexpected glimpse of him induced an epileptic fit in a man who had come to repair his electric desk lamp, a fit for which he described effectively while keeping himself well out of sight. That man, oddly enough, had been through the terrors of the Great War without having incurred any fright so thorough. Then, in the middle of October, the horror of horrors came with stupefying suddenness. One night, about 11, the pump of the refrigerating machine broke down, so that within 3 hours the process of ammonia cooling became impossible. Dr. Munoz summoned me by thumping on the floor, and I worked desperately to repair the injury while my host cursed in a tone whose lifeless, rattling hollowness surpassed description. My amateur efforts, however, proved of no use, and when I had brought in a mechanic from a neighboring all-night garage, we learned that nothing could be done till morning, when a new piston would have to be obtained. The moribund hermit's rage and fear, swelling to grotesque proportions, seemed likely to shatter what remained of his failing physique, and once a spasm caused him to clap his hands to his eyes and rush to the bathroom. He groped his way out with a face tightly bandaged, and I never saw his eyes again. The frigidity of the apartment was now sensibly diminishing, and at about 5 a.m. the doctor retired to the bathroom, commanding me to keep him supplied with all the ice I could obtain at all-night drugstores and cafeterias. As I would return from my sometimes discouraging trips and lay my spoils before the closed bathroom door, I could hear a restless splashing within, and a thick voice croaking out the order for more, more. At length, a warm day broke, and the shops opened one by one. I asked Esteban either to help with the ice fetching whilst I obtained the pump piston, or to order the piston while I continued with the ice, but, instructed by his mother, he absolutely refused. Finally, I hired a seedy-looking loafer whom I encountered on the corner of 8th Avenue to keep the patient supplied with ice from a little shop while I introduced him, and applied myself diligently to the task of finding a pump piston and engaging workmen competent to install it. The task seemed interminable, and I almost raged as violently as the hermit when I saw the hours slipping by in a breathless, foodless round of vain telephoning and a hectic quest from place to place, hither to thither by subway and surface car. About noon, I encountered a suitable supply house far downtown, and at approximately 1:30 p.m. arrived at my boarding place with the necessary paraphernalia and two sturdy and intelligent mechanics. I had done all I could and hoped I was in time. Black Terror, however, had preceded me. The house was in utter turmoil, and above the chatter of odd voices, I heard a man praying in a deep basso. Fiendish things were in the air, and lodgers tolled over the beads of their rosaries as they caught the odor from beneath the doctor's closed door. The lounger I had hired, it seems, had fled screaming and mad-eyed not longer after his second delivery of ice, perhaps as a result of excessive curiosity. He could not, of course, have locked the door behind him, yet it was now fastened, presumably from the inside. There was no sound within save a nameless sort of slow, thick dripping. Briefly consulting with Mrs. Herrero and the workmen, despite a fear that gnawed my inmost soul, I advised the breaking down of the door, but the landlady found a way to turn the key from the outside with some wire device. We had previously opened the doors of all the other rooms on that hall and flung open the windows to the very top. Now, noses protected by handkerchiefs, we tremblingly invaded the accursed south room, which blazed with the warm sun of early afternoon. A kind of dark, slimy trail led from the open bathroom door to the hall door, and thence to the desk where a terrible little pool had accumulated. Something was scrawled there in pencil, in an awful, blind hand on a piece of paper hideously smeared as though by the very claws that traced the hurried last words. Then the trail led to the couch and ended unutterably. What was or had been on the couch I cannot and dare not say here, but this is what I shiveringly puzzled out on the stickly smeared paper before I drew a match and burned it to a crisp. What I puzzled out in terror, as the landlady and two mechanics rushed frantically from that hellish place to babble their incoherent stories at the nearest police station. The nauseous words seemed well-nigh incredible in that yellow sunlight, with the clatter of cars and motor trucks ascending clamorously from crowded 14th Street. Yet I confess that I believe them now. Whether I believe them now, I honestly don't know. There are things about which it is better not to speculate, and all that I can say is that I hate the smell of ammonia and grow faint at a draught of unusually cool air. "The end," ran the noisome scrawl, "is here. No more ice." The man looked and ran away. Warmer every minute, and the tissues can't last. I fancy you know what I said about the will and the nerves and the preserved body after the organs ceased to work. It was a good theory, but couldn't keep up indefinitely. There was a gradual deterioration I had not foreseen. Dr. Torres knew, but the shock killed him. He couldn't stand what he had to do. He had to get me in a strange dark place when he minded my letter and nursed me back. And the organs would never work again. It had to be done my way. Preservation. For, you see, I died that time, 18 years ago.
Pickman's Model. You needn't think I'm crazy, Elliot. Plenty of others have queerer prejudices than this. Why don't you laugh at Oliver's grandfather, who won't ride in a motor? If I don't like that damn subway, it's my own business, and we got here more quickly anyhow in the taxi. We'd have had to walk up the hill from Park Street if we'd taken the car. I know I'm more nervous than I was when you saw me last year, but you don't need to hold a clinic over it. There's plenty of reason, God knows, and I'm fancy I'm lucky to be sane at all. Why, the third degree? You didn't used to be so inquisitive. Well, if you must hear it, I don't know why you shouldn't. Maybe you ought to anyhow, for you kept writing me like a grieved parent when you heard I'd begun to cut the art club and keep away from Pickman. Now that he's disappeared, I go around to the club once in a while, but my nerves aren't what they were. No, I don't know what became of Pickman, and I don't like to guess. You might have surmised I had some inside information when I dropped him, and that's why I don't want to think where he's gone. Let the police find what they can. It won't be much, judging from the fact that they don't know yet of the old North End place he'd hired under the name of Peters. I'm not sure that I would find it again myself. Not that I'd ever try, even in broad daylight. Yes, I do know, or am afraid I know, why he maintained it. I'm coming to that. And I think you'll understand, before I'm through, why I don't tell the police. They would ask me to guide them, but I couldn't go back there even if I knew the way. There was something there. And now I can't use the subway, or, as you may well have your laugh at this too, go down into cellars anymore. I think you'd have known I didn't drop Pickman for the same silly reasons that fussy old women like Dr. Reed or Joe Mina or Bosworth did. Morbid art doesn't shock me, and when a man has the genius Pickman had, I feel it an honor to know him, no matter what direction his work takes. Boston never had a greater painter than Richard Upton Pickman. I said it at first, and I say it still, and I never swerved an inch either when he showed that ghoul feeding that, you remember, was when Minot cut him. You know, it takes profound art and profound insight into nature to turn out stuff like Pickman's. Any magazine cover hack can splash paint around wildly and call it a nightmare or a witch's Sabbath or a portrait of the devil. But only a great painter can make such a thing really scare or ring true. That's because only a real artist knows the actual anatomy of the terrible or the psychology of fear. The exact sort of lines and proportions that connect up with latent instincts or hereditary memories of fright, and the proper color contrasts and lighting effects to stir the dormant sense of strangeness. I don't have to tell you why a Fuseli really brings a shiver, while a cheap ghost story frontispiece merely makes us laugh. There's something those fellows catch, beyond life, that they're able to make us catch for a second. Doré had it. Chimay has it, and Girola of Chicago has it, and Pickman had it, as no man ever had it before, or I hope to heaven ever will again. Don't ask me what it is they see. You know, in ordinary art, there's all the difference in the world between the vital, breathing things drawn from nature or models and the artificial truck that commercial small fry reel off in a bare studio by rule. Well, I should say that the really weird artist has a kind of vision which makes models or summons up what amounts to actual scenes from the spectral world he lives in. Anyhow, he manages to turn out results that differ from the pretender's mince pie dreams in just about the same way that the life painter's results differ from the concoctions of a correspondent school cartoonist. If I had ever seen what Pickman saw. But no. Here, let's have a drink before we get any deeper. Gad, I wouldn't be alive if I'd ever seen what that man, if he was a man, saw. You recall that Pickman's forte was faces. I don't believe anyone since Goya could put so much sheer hell into a set of features or a twist of expression. And before Goya, you had to go back to the medieval chaps who did the gargoyles and chimeras on Notre Dame and Mont-Saint-Michel. They believed all sorts of things, and maybe they saw all sorts of things, too, for the Middle Ages had some curious phases. I remember you were asking Pickman once yourself, the year before he went away, whether in thunder he got such ideas and visions. Wasn't that a nasty laugh he gave you? It was partly because of that laugh that Reed dropped him. Reed, you know, had just taken up comparative pathology and was full of pompous inside stuff about the biological or evolutionary significance of this or that mental or physical symptom. He said Pickman repelled him more and more every day. It almost frightened him toward the last. That the fellow's features and expressions were slowly developing in a way he didn't like. In a way that wasn't human. He had a lot of talk about diet and said Pickman must be abnormal and eccentric to the last degree. I suppose you told Reed, if you and he had any correspondence over it, that he'd let Pickman's paintings get on his nerves or harrow up his imagination. I told him that myself, then. But keep in mind, I didn't drop Pickman for anything like this. On the contrary, my admiration for him kept growing, for that ghoul feeding was a tremendous achievement. As you know, the club wouldn't exhibit it, and the Museum of Fine Arts wouldn't accept it as a gift, and I can add that nobody would buy it. So Pickman had it right in his house till he went. Now his father has it in Salem. You know, Pickman comes of old Salem stock and had a witch ancestor hanged in 1692. I got into the habit of calling on Pickman quite often, especially after I began making notes for a monograph on weird art. Probably it was his work which put the idea into my head, and anyhow, I found him a mine of data and suggestions when I came to develop it. He showed me all the paintings and drawings he had about, including some pen and ink sketches that would, I verily believe, have gotten him kicked out of the club if many of the members had seen them. Before long, I was pretty near a devotee and would listen for hours like a schoolboy to art theories and philosophic speculation wild enough to qualify him for the Danvers Asylum. My hero worship, coupled with the fact that people generally were commencing to have less and less to do with him, made him get very confidential with me. And one evening, he hinted that if I were fairly close-mouthed and none too squeamish, he might show me something rather unusual, something a bit stronger than anything he had in the house. "You know," he said, "there are things that won't do for Newberry Street. Things that are out of place here, and that can't be conceived here anyhow. It's my business to catch the overtones of the soul, and anything yet, because it's had no time to pick up memories and attract local spirits. If there are any ghosts here, they're the tame ghosts of a salt marsh and a shallow cove, and I want human ghosts, the ghosts of beings highly organized enough to have looked on hell and known the meaning of what they saw. The place for an artist to live is the North End. If any aesthete were sincere, he'd put up with the slums for the sake of the mass traditions. God, man, don't you realize that places like that weren't merely made, but actually grew? Generation after generation lived and felt and died there. And in days when people weren't afraid to live and feel and die, don't you know there was a mill on Cops Hill in 1632, and that half the present streets were laid out by 1650? I can show you houses that have stood for 2.5 centuries or more. Houses that have witnessed what would make a modern house crumble into powder. What do moderns know of life and the forces behind it? You call the Salem witchcraft a delusion, but I'll wager my 4 times great-grandmother could have told you things. They hanged her on Gallows Hill, with Cotton Mather looking sanctimoniously on. Mather, damn him, was afraid somebody might succeed in kicking free of this accursed cage of monotony. I wish someone had laid a spell on him or sucked his blood in the night. I can show you a house he lived in, and I can show you another one he was afraid to enter, in spite of all his fine, bold talk. He knew things he didn't dare put into that stupid Magnalia, or that puerile wonders of the invisible world. Look here, do you know the whole North End once had a set of tunnels that kept certain people in touch with each other's houses? And the burying ground, and the sea. Let them prosecute and persecute above ground. Things went on every day that they couldn't reach, and the voices laughed at night when they couldn't place. Why, man, out of 10 surviving houses built before 1700 and not moved since, I'll wager that in 8 I can show you something queer in the cellar. There's hardly a month that you don't read of workmen finding bricked-up arches and wells leading nowhere in this or that old place as it comes down. You could see one near Henchman Street from the elevated last year. There were witches and what their spells summoned, pirates and what they brought in from the sea, smugglers, privateers, and I tell you, people knew how to live and how to enlarge the bounds of life in the old times. This wasn't the only world a bold and wise man could know. And to think of today in contrast with such pale pink brains that even a club of supposed artists get shudders and convulsions if a picture goes beyond the feelings of a Beacon Street tea table. The only saving grace of the present is that it's too damn stupid to question the past very closely. What do maps and records and guidebooks really tell of the North End? Blah, at a guess, I'll guarantee to lead you to 30 or 40 alleys and networks of alleys north of Prince Street that aren't suspected by 10 living beings outside of the foreigners that swarm them. And what did those Dagos know of their meaning? Nah, Thurber. These ancient places are dreaming gorgeously and overflowing with wonder and terror and escapes from the commonplace. And yet, there is not a living soul to understand or profit by them. Or rather, there's only one living soul, for I haven't been digging around in the past for nothing. See here, you're interested in this sort of thing. What if I told you that I've got another studio up there, where I can catch the night spirit of antique horror and paint things I couldn't even think of in Newberry Street? Naturally, I don't tell those cursed old maids at the club, with Reed, damn him. Whispering, even as it is, that I'm sort of monster-bound down the toboggan of reverse evolution. Yes, Thurber, I decided long ago that one must paint terror as well as beauty from life, so I did some exploring in places where I had reason to know terror lives. I've got a place that I don't believe three living Nordic men beside myself have ever seen. It isn't so very far from the elevated as distance goes, but it's centuries away as the soul goes. I took it because of the queer old brick well in the cellar, one of the sort I told you about. The shack's almost tumbling down so that nobody else would live there, and I'd hate to tell you how little I pay for it. The windows are boarded up, but I like all that the better, since I don't want daylight for what I do. I paint in the cellar where the inspiration is thickest, but I have other rooms furnished on the ground floor. A Sicilian owns it, and I've hired it under the name of Peters. Now, if you're game, I'll take you there tonight. I think you'd enjoy the pictures, for as I've said, I've let myself go a bit there. It's no vast tour. I sometimes do it on foot, for I don't want to attract attention, with a taxi in such a place. We can take the shuttle at the South Station for Battery Street, and after that, the walk isn't much. Well, Elliot, there wasn't much for me to do after that harangue, but to keep myself from running instead of walking for the first vacant cab we could sight. We changed at the elevated at the South Station, and at about 12 o'clock had climbed down the steps at Battery Street and struck along the old waterfront past Constitution Wharf. I didn't keep track of the cross streets, and I can't tell you yet which it was we turned up, but I know it wasn't Greenough Lane. When we did turn, it was to climb through the deserted length of the oldest and dirtiest alley I've ever saw in my life, with crumbling-looking gables, broken small-paned windows, and archaic chimneys that stood out half-disintegrated against the moonlit sky. I don't believe there were three houses in sight that hadn't been standing in Cotton Mather's time. Certainly I glimpsed at least two with an overhang, and once I thought I saw a peaked roofline of the almost forgotten pre-gambrel type, though antiquarians tell me there are none left in Boston. From that alley, which had a dim light, we turned to the left into an equally silent and still narrower alley with no light at all. And in a minute, made what I think was an obtuse angled bend toward the right in the dark. Not long after this, Pickman produced a flashlight and revealed an antediluvian 10-paneled door that looked damnably worm-eaten. Unlocking it, he ushered me into a barren hallway that was once splendid dark oak paneling, simple, of course, but thrilling, suggestive of the times of Andros and Phipps and witchcraft. Then he took me through a door on the left, lighted an oil lamp, and told me to make myself at home. Now, Elliot, I'm what the man in the street would call fairly hard-boiled, but I'll confess that what I saw on the walls of that room gave me a bad turn. They were his pictures, you know, the ones he couldn't paint or even show in Newberry Street, and he was right when he said he had let himself go. Here, have another drink. I need one anyhow. There's no use in my trying to tell you what they were like, because the awful, the blasphemous horror, and the unbelievable loathsomeness and moral folklore came from simple touches quite beyond the power of words to classify. There was none of the exotic technique you see in Sidney's Chime, none of the transanturnian landscapes and lunar fungi that Clark Ashton Smith uses to freeze the blood. The backgrounds were mostly old churchyards, deep woods, cliffs by the sea, brick tunnels, ancient paneled rooms, and simple vaults of masonry.
Cops Hill Burying Ground, which could not be many blocks away from this very house, was a favorite scene. The madness and monstrosity lay in the figures in the foreground. For Pickman's morbid art was preeminently one of demoniac portraiture. These figures were seldomly completely human, but often approached humanity in varying degree. Most of the bodies, well, roughly bipedal, had a forward, slumping, and a vaguely canine cast. The texture of the majority was a kind of unpleasant rubberiness. Ugh, I can see them now. Their occupations, well, don't ask me to be too precise. They were usually feeding, I won't say on what. They were sometimes shown in groups in cemeteries or underground passages, and often appeared to be in a battle over their prey, or rather, their treasure trove. And what damnable expressiveness Pickman sometimes gave the sightless faces on this carnal booty. Occasionally, the things were shown leaping through open windows at night, or squatting on the chests of sleepers, worrying at their throats. One canvas showed a ring of them baying about a hanged witch on Gallows Hill, whose dead face held a close kinship to theirs. But don't get the idea that it was all this hideous business of theme and setting which struck me faint. I met a 3-year-old kid, and I'd seen much like this before. It was the faces, Elliot. Those accursed faces that leered and slavered out of the canvas with the very breath of life. By God, man, I verily believe they were alive. That nauseous wizard had waked the fires of hell in Pigment, and his brush had been a nightmare-spawning wand. Give me that decanter, Elliot. There was one thing called the lesson. Heaven pity me that I ever saw it. Listen. Can you fancy a squatting circle of nameless dog-like things in a churchyard teaching a small child how to feed like themselves? The price for a changeling, I suppose? You know, the old myth about how the weird people leave their spawn in cradles in exchange for the human babes they steal? Pickman was showing what happens to those stolen babies, how they grow up. And then I began to see a hideous relationship in the faces of the human and non-human figures. He was, in all his gradations of morbidity, between the frankly non-human and the degradingly human, establishing a sardonic linkage and evolution. The dog things were developed from mortals. And no sooner had I wondered what he made of their own young, as left with mankind, in the form of changelings, that my eye caught a picture embodying that very thought. It was that of an ancient Puritan interior, a heavily beamed room with latticed windows, a settle and clumsy 17th century furniture, with the family sitting about while father read from the scriptures. Every face but one showed nobility and reverence, but that one reflected the mockery of the pit. It was that of a young man in years, and no doubt belonged to a supposed son of that pious father, but in essence, it was the kin of the unclean things. It was their changeling. And in a spirit of supreme irony, Pickman had given the features a very perceptible resemblance to his own. By this time, Pickman had lighted a lamp in an adjoining room and was politely holding open the door for me, asking me if I would care to see his modern studies. I hadn't been able to give him much of my opinions. I was too speechless with fright and loathing. But I think he fully understood and felt highly complimented. And now I want to assure you again, Elliot, that I'm no mollycoddle to scream at anything which shows a bit of departure from the usual. I'm middle-aged and decently sophisticated, and I guess you saw enough of me in France to know I'm not easily knocked out. Remember, too, that I'd just about recovered my wind and gotten used to those frightful pictures which turned colonial New England into a kind of annex of hell. Well, in spite of all this, that next room forced a real scream out of me, and I had to clutch at the doorway to keep from keeling over. The other chamber had shown a pack of ghouls and witches overturning the world of our forefathers, but this one brought the horror right into our own daily life. Gad, how that man could paint! There was a study called Subway Accident, in which a flock of the vile things were clambering up from some unknown catacomb through a crack in the floor of the Boylston Street subway and attacking a crowd of people at the platform. Another showed a dance on Copp's Hill among the tombs with the background of today. Then there were any number of cellar views with monsters creeping in through holes and rifts in the masonry and grinning as they squatted behind barrels or furnaces and waited for their first victim to descend the stairs. One disgusting canvas seemed to depict a vast cross-section of Beacon Hill with ant-like armies of the mephitic monsters squeezing themselves through burrows that honeycombed the ground. Dances in the modern cemeteries were freely pictured, and another conception somehow shocked me more than all the rest, a scene in an unknown vault where scores of the beast crowded about one who held a well-known Boston guidebook and was evidently reading aloud. All were pointing to a certain passage, and every face seemed so distorted with epileptic and reverberant laughter that I almost thought I heard the fiendish echoes. The title of the picture was Holmes, Lowell, and Longfellow Lie Buried in Mount Auburn. As I gradually steadied myself and got readjusted to this second room of deviltry and morbidity, I began to analyze some of the points in my sickening loathing. In the first place, I said to myself, these things repelled because of the utter inhumanity and callous cruelty they showed in Pickman. The fellow must be a relentless enemy of all mankind to take such glee in the torture of brain and flesh and the degradation of the mortal tenement. In the second place, they terrified because of their very greatness. Their art was the art that convinced. When we saw the pictures we saw, the demons themselves, and were afraid of them, and the queer part was that Pickman got none of the power from the use of selectiveness or bizarrery. Nothing was blurred, distorted, or conventionalized. Outlines were sharp and lifelike, and details were almost painfully defined in the faces. It was not any mere artist's interpretation that we saw. It was pandemonium itself, crystal clear in stark objectivity. That was it, by heaven. The man was not a fantasist or romanticist at all. He did not even try to give us the churning, prismatic ephemera of dreams, but coldly and sardonically reflected some stable, mechanistic, and well-established horror world which he saw fully, brilliantly, squarely, and unfalteringly. God knows what the world can have been, or where he ever glimpsed the blasphemous shapes that loped and trotted and crawled through it. But whatever the baffling source of his images, one thing was plain. Pickman was, in every sense, in conception and in execution, a thorough, painstaking, and almost scientific realist. My host was now leading the way down cellar to his actual studio, and I braced myself for some hellish effects among the unfinished canvases. As we reached the bottom of the damp stairs, he turned his flashlight to a corner of the large open space at hand, revealing the circular brick curb of what was evidently a great well in the earthen floor. We walked nearer, and I saw that it must be 5 feet across, with walls a good foot thick and some 6 inches above the ground level. Solid work of the 17th century, or I was much mistaken. That, Pickman said, was the kind of thing he had been talking about. An aperture of the network of tunnels that used to undermine the hill. I noticed idly that it did not seem to be bricked up, and that a heavy disk of wood formed the apparent cover. Think of the things this well must have been connected with. If Pickman's wild hints had not been mere rhetoric, I shivered slightly, then turned to follow him up a step and through a narrow door into a room of fair size, provided with a wooden floor and furnished as a studio, and an acetylene gas outfit gave the light necessary for work. The unfinished pictures on easels or propped up against the walls were as ghastly as the finished ones upstairs and showed the painstaking methods of the artist. Scenes were blocked out with extreme care, and pencil guidelines told of the minute exactitude which Pickman used in getting the right perspective and proportions. The man was great. I say it even now, knowing as much as I do. A large camera on a table excited my notice, and Pickman told me that he used it in taking scenes for backgrounds, so that he might paint them from photographs in the studio, instead of carting his outfit around the town for this or that view. He thought a photograph quite as good as an actual scene or model for sustained work, and he declared he employed them regularly. There was something very disturbing about the nauseous sketches and half-finished monstrosities that leered around from every side of the room, and when Pickman suddenly unveiled a huge canvas on the side, away from the light, I could not for my life keep back a loud scream, the second I had admitted that night. It echoed and echoed through the dim vaultings of that ancient and nitrous cellar, and I had to choke back a flood of reaction that threatened to burst out as hysterical laughter. Merciful Creator! Elliot, but I don't know how much was real and how much was feverish fantasy. It doesn't seem to me that Earth can hold a dream like that. It was a colossal and nameless blasphemy with glaring red eyes, and it held in bony claws a thing that had been a man, gnawing at the head as a child nibbles at a stick of candy. Its position was a kind of crouch, and as one looked, one felt that at any moment it might drop its present prey and seek a juicier morsel. But damn it all, it wasn't even the fiendish subject that made it such an immortal fountainhead of all panic. Not that, nor the dog face with its pointed ears, bloodshot eyes, flat nose, and drilling lips. It wasn't the scaly claws, nor the mud-caked body, nor the half-hooved feet. None of these, though any one of them might well have driven an excitable man to madness. It was the technique, Elliot. The cursed, impious, the unnatural technique. As I am a living being, I never elsewhere saw the actual breath of life so fused into a canvas. The monster was there. It glared, and gnawed, and gnawed, and gnawed, and glared. And I knew that only a suspension of nature's laws could ever let a man paint a thing like that without a model, without some glimpse of the netherworld which no mortal unsold to the fiend has ever had. Pinned with a thumbtack to a vacant part of the canvas was a piece of paper now badly curled up. Probably, I thought, a photograph from which Pickman meant to paint a background as hideous as the nightmare it was to enhance. I reached out to uncurl and look at it when I suddenly saw Pickman start as if shot. He had been listening with peculiar intensity ever since my shocked scream had waked unaccustomed echoes in the dark cellar. And now he seemed struck with a fright which, though not comparable to my own, had in it more of the physical than the spiritual. He drew a revolver and motioned me to silence, then stepped out into the main cellar and closed the door behind him. I think I was paralyzed for an instant. Imitating Pickman's listening, I fancied I heard a faint scurrying sound somewhere and a series of squeals or bleats in a direction I couldn't determine. I thought of huge rats and shuddered. Then there came a subdued sort of clatter which somehow set me all in goose flesh. A furtive, groping kind of clatter, though I can't attempt to convey what I mean in words. It was like heavy wood falling on stone or brick. Wood on brick, what did that make me think of? It came again, and louder. There was a vibration as if the wood had fallen farther than it had fallen before. After that followed a sharp grating noise, a shouted gibberish from Pickman, and the deafening discharge of all six chambers of the revolver fired spectacularly as a lion tamer might fire in the air for effect, a muffled squeal or squawk, and then a thud. Then more wood and brick grating, a pause, and the opening of the door. At which, I'll confess, I started violently. Pickman reappeared with his smoking weapon, cursing the bloated rats that infested the ancient well. "The deuce knows what they ate, Thurber," he grinned, "for those archaic tunnels touched graveyard and witch den and seacoast. But whatever it is, they must have run short, for they were devilish anxious to get out. Your yelling stirred them up, I fancy. Better be cautious in these old places. Our rodent friends are the one drawback, though I sometimes think they're a positive asset by way of atmosphere and color." Well, Elliot, that was the end of the night's adventure. Pickman had promised to show me the place, and heaven knows he had done it. He led me out of that tangle of alleys in another direction, it seems, for when we sighted a lamppost, we were in a half-familiar street with monotonous rows of mingled tenement blocks and old houses. Charter Street, it turned out to be, but I was too flustered to notice just where we hit it. We were too late for the elevated, and walked back downtown through Hanover Street. I remember that walk. We switched from Tremont up Beacon, and Pickman left me at a corner of Joy, where I turned off. I never spoke to him again. Why did I drop him?
Don't be impatient. Wait till I ring for coffee. We've had enough of the other stuff, but I, for one, need something. No, it wasn't the paintings I saw in that place, though I swear they were enough to get him ostracized in 9/10 of the homes and clubs of Boston. And I guess you won't wonder now why I have to steer clear of subways and cellars. It was something I found in my coat the next morning. You know, the curl-up paper tacked to that frightful canvas in the cellar. The thing I thought was a photograph of some scene he meant to use as a background for that monster. That last scare had come while I was reaching to uncurl it, and it seems I had vaguely crumpled it into my pocket. But here's the coffee. Take it black, Elliot, if you're wise. Yes, that paper was the reason I dropped Pickman. Richard Upton Pickman. The greatest artist I've ever known, and the foulest being that ever leapt the bounds of life into the pits of myth and madness. Elliot, old Reed was right. He wasn't strictly human. Either he was born in strange shadow, or he'd found a way to unblock the forbidden gate. It's all the same now, for he's gone. Back into the fabulous darkness he loved to haunt. Here, let's have the chandelier going. Don't ask me to explain, or even conjecture about what I burned. Don't ask me either what lay beyond that mole-like scrambling Pickman was so keen to pass off as rats. There are secrets, you know, which might have come down from old Salem times, and Cotton Mather tells even stranger things. You know how damned lifelike Pickman's paintings were, how we all wondered where he got those faces? Well, that paper wasn't a photograph of any background after all. What it showed was simply the monstrous being he was painting on that awful canvas. It was the model he was using, and its background was merely the wall of the studio cellar in minute detail. But by God, Elliot, it was a photograph from life.
The Terrible Old Man. It was the design of Angelo Ricci and Joe Czernik and Manuel Silva to call on the terrible old man. This old man dwells all alone in a very ancient house on Water Street near the sea, and is reputed to be both exceedingly rich and exceedingly feeble, which forms a situation very attractive to men of the profession of Messrs. Ricci, Czernik, and Silva, for that profession was nothing less dignified than robbery. The inhabitants of Kingsport say and think many things about the terrible old man, which generally keep him safe from the attention of gentlemen like Mr. Ricci and his colleagues, despite the almost certain fact that he hides a fortune of indefinite magnitude somewhere about his musty and venerable abode. He is, in truth, a very strange person, believed to have been a captain of East India clipper ships in his day, so old that no one can remember when he was young, and so taciturn that few know his real name. Among the gnarled trees in the front yard of his aged and neglected place, he maintains a strange collection of large stones, oddly grouped, and painted so that they resemble the idols in some obscure eastern temple. This collection frightens away most of the small boys who love to taunt the terrible old man about his long white hair and beard, or to break the small paned windows of his dwelling with wicked missiles. But there are other things which frighten the older and more curious folk, who sometimes steal up to the house to peer in through the dusty panes. These folks say that on a table, in a bare room on the ground floor, are many peculiar bottles, in each a small piece of lead suspended pendulum-wise from a string. And they say that the terrible old man talks to these bottles, addressing them by such names as Jack, Scarface, Long Tom, Spanish Joe, Peters, and Mate Ellis, and that whenever he speaks to a bottle, the little lead pendulum within makes certain definite vibrations as if in answer. Those who have watched the tall, lean, terrible old man in these peculiar conversations do not watch him again. But Angelo Ricci and Joe Chanet and Manuel Silva were not of Kingsport blood. They were of that new and heterogeneous alien stock, which lies outside the charmed circle of New England life and traditions. And they saw in the terrible old man merely a tottering, almost helpless graybeard, who could not walk without the aid of his knotted cane, and whose thin, weak hands shook pitifully. They were really quite sorry in their way for the lonely, unpopular old fellow whom everyone shunned, and at whom all the dogs barked singularly. But business is business, and to a robber whose soul is in his profession, there is a lure and a challenge about a very old and very feeble man who has no account at the bank, and who pays for his few necessities at the village store with Spanish gold and silver minted 2 centuries ago. Messrs. Ricci, Chanek, and Silva selected the night of April 11th for their call. Mr. Ricci and Mr. Silva were to interview the poor old gentleman, whilst Mr. Chanek waited for them and their presumable metallic burden with a covered motor car in Ship Street by the gate in the tall rear wall of their host's grounds. Desire to avoid needless explanations in case of unexpected police intrusions prompted these plans for a quiet and unostentatious departure. As prearranged, the 3 adventurers started out separately in order to prevent any evil-minded suspicions afterward. Messrs. Ricci and Silva met in Water Street by the old man's front gate, and although they did not like the way the moon shone down upon the painted stones through the budding branches of the gnarled trees, they had more important things to think about than mere idle superstition. They feared it might be unpleasant work making the terrible old man loquacious concerning his hoarded gold and silver, for aged sea captains are notably stubborn and perverse. Still, he was very old and very feeble, and there were 2 visitors. Mrs. Ricci and Silva were experienced in the art of making unwilling persons voluble, and the screams of a weak and exceptionally venerable man can be easily muffled. So they moved up to the 1 lighted window and heard the terrible old man talking childishly to his bottles with pendulums. Then they donned masks, and knocked politely, at the weather-stained oaken door. Waiting seemed very long to Mr. Chanek, as he fidgeted restlessly in the covered motor car by the terrible old man's back gate in Ship Street. He was more than ordinarily tender-hearted, and he did not like the hideous screams he had heard in the ancient house just after the hour appointed for the deed. Had he not told his colleagues to be as gentle as possible with a pathetic old sea captain? Very nervously he watched that narrow oaken gate and the high and ivy-clad stone wall. Frequently he consulted his watch and wondered at the delay. Had the old man died before revealing where his treasure was hidden, and had a thorough search become necessary? Mr. Chanick did not like to wait so long in the dark in such a place. Then he sensed a soft tread or tapping on the walk inside the gate, heard a gentle fumbling at the rusty latch, and saw the narrow, heavy door swing inward. And in the pallid glow of the single dim street lamp, he strained his eyes to see what his colleagues had brought out of that sinister house, which loomed so close behind. But when he looked, he did not see what he had expected, for his colleagues were not there at all, but only the terrible old man, leaning quietly on his knotted cane and smiling hideously. Mr. Chanick had never before noticed the color of that man's eyes. Now he saw that they were yellow. Little things make considerable excitement in little towns, which is the reason that Kingsport people talked all that spring and summer about the three unidentifiable bodies, horribly slashed as with many cutlasses, and horribly mangled as by the tread of many cruel boot heels, which the tide washed in. And some people even spoke of things as trivial as the deserted motor car found in Ship Street, or certain especially inhuman cries, probably of a stray animal or migratory bird, heard in the night by wakeful citizens. But in this idle village gossip, the terrible old man took no interest at all. He was by nature reserved, and when one is aged and feeble, one's reserve is doubly strong. Besides, so ancient a sea captain must have witnessed scores of things, much more stirring, in the far-off days of his unremembered youth. The Lurking Fear, Chapter 1. The Shadow on the Chimney. There was thunder in the air on the night I went to the deserted mansion atop Tempest Mountain to find the Lurking Fear. I was not alone, for foolhardiness was not then mixed with that love of the grotesque and the terrible which has made my career a series of quests for strange horrors in literature and in life. With me were two faithful and muscular men for whom I had sent when the time came, men long associated with me in my ghastly explorations because of their peculiar fitness. We had started quietly from the village because of the reporters who still lingered about after the Eldritch panic of a month before, the nightmare creeping death. Later I thought they might aid me, but I did not want them then. Would to God I had let them share the search, that I might not have had to bear the secret alone so long. To bear it alone for fear the world would call me mad or go mad itself at the demoned implications of the thing. Now that I'm telling it anyway, lest the brooding make me a maniac, I wish I had never concealed it. For I, and only I, know what manner of fear lurked on that spectral and desolate mountain. In a small motor car, we covered the miles of primeval forest and hill until the wooded ascent checked it. The country bore an aspect more than usually sinister as we viewed it by night, and without the accustomed crowds of investigators, so that we were often tempted to use the acetylene headlight despite the attention it might attract. It was not a wholesome landscape after dark, and I believe I would have noticed its morbidity even had I been ignorant of the terror that stalked there. Of wild creatures, there were none. They were wise when death leers close. The ancient lightning-scarred trees seemed unnaturally large and twisted, and the other vegetation unnaturally thick and feverish, while curious mounds and hummocks in the weedy, fulgurate, pitted earth reminded me of snakes and dead men's skulls swelled to gigantic proportions. Fear had lurked on Tempest Mountain for more than a century. This I learned at once from newspaper accounts of the catastrophe, which first brought the region to the world's notice. The place is a remote, lonely elevation in that part of the Catskills where Dutch civilization once feebly and transiently penetrated, leaving behind, as it receded, only a few ruined mansions and a degenerate squatter population inhabiting pitiful hamlets on isolated slopes. Normal beings seldom visited the locality till the state police were formed, and even now only infrequent troopers patrol it. The fear, however, is an old tradition throughout the neighboring villages, since it is a prime topic in the simple discourse of the poor mongrels who sometimes leave their valleys to trade hand-woven baskets for such primitive necessities as they cannot shoot, raise, or make. The lurking fear dwelt in the shunned and deserted Martens mansion, which crowned the high but gradual eminence, whose liability to frequent thunderstorms gave it the name of Tempest Mountain. For over 100 years, the antique, grove-circled stone house had been the subject of stories incredibly wild and monstrously hideous. Stories of a silent, colossal, creeping death, which stalked abroad in summer. With whimpering insistence, the squatters told tales of a demon which seized lone wayfarers after dark, either carrying them off or leaving them in a frightful state of gnawed dismemberment, while sometimes they whispered of blood trails toward the distant mansion. Some said the thunder called the lurking fear out of its habitation, while others said the thunder was its voice. No one outside the backwoods had believed these varying and conflicting stories, with their incoherent, extravagant descriptions of the half-glimpsed fiend. Yet not a farmer or villager doubted that the Martens mansion was ghoulishly haunted. Local history forbade such a doubt, although no ghostly evidence was ever found by such investigators as had visited the building after some especially vivid tale of the squatters. Grandmothers told strange myths of the Martens specter, myths concerning the Martens family itself, its queer hereditary dissimilarity of eyes, its long unnatural annals, and the murder which had cursed it. The terror which brought me to the scene was a sudden and portentous confirmation of the mountaineer's wildest legends. One summer night, after a thunderstorm of unprecedented violence, the countryside was aroused by a squatter stampede which no mere delusion could create. The pitiful throngs of natives shrieked and whined of the unnameable horror which had descended upon them, and they were not doubted. They had not seen it, but had heard such cries from one of their hamlets that they knew a creeping death had come. In the morning, citizens and state troopers followed the shuddering mountaineers to the place where they said the death had come. Death was indeed there. The ground under one of the squatters' villages had caved in after a lightning stroke, destroying several of the malodorous shanties, but upon this property damage was superimposed an organic devastation which paled it to insignificance. Of a possible 75 natives who had inhabited this spot, not one living specimen was visible. The disordered earth was covered with blood and human debris, bespeaking too vividly the ravages of demon teeth and talons, yet no visible trail led away from the carnage. That some hideous animal must be the cause, everyone quickly agreed, nor did any tongue now revive the charge that such cryptic deaths formed merely the sordid murders common in decadent communities. That charge was revived only when about 25 of the estimated population were found missing from the dead, and even then it was hard to explain the murder of 50 by half that number. But the fact remained that on a summer night a bolt had come out of the heavens and left a dead village whose corpses were horribly mangled, chewed, and clawed. The excited countryside immediately connected the horror with the haunted Martens mansion, though the localities were over 3 miles apart. The troopers were more skeptical, including the mansion only casually in their investigations, and dropping it altogether when they found it thoroughly deserted. Country and village people, however, canvassed the place with infinite care, overturning everything in the house, saving ponds and brooks, beating down bushes, and ransacking the nearby forests. All was in vain. The death that had come had left no trace, save destruction itself. By the second day of the search, the affair was fully treated by the newspapers, whose reporters overran Tempest Mountain. They described it in much detail, and with many interviews to elucidate the horror's history as told by local grandams. I followed the accounts languidly at first, for I am a connoisseur in horrors. But after a week, I detected an atmosphere which stirred me oddly, so that on August 5th, 1921, I registered among the reporters who crowded the hotel at Lafert's Corners, nearest village to the Tempest Mountain, and acknowledged headquarters of the searchers. 3 weeks more, and the dispersal of the reporters left me free to begin a terrible explanation based on the minute inquiries and surveying with which I had meanwhile busied myself. So, on this summer night, while distant thunder rumbled, I left a silent motor car and tramped with two armed companions up the last mound-covered reaches of Tempest Mountain, casting the beams of an electric torch on the gray spectral walls that began to appear through giant oaks ahead. In this morbid night, solitude and feeble shifting illumination, the vast box-like pile displayed obscure hints of terror which day could not uncover. Yet I did not hesitate, since I had come with fierce resolution to test an idea. I believed that the thunder called the death demon out of some fearsome secret place, and be that demon solid entity or vaporous pestilence, I meant to see it. I had thoroughly searched the ruin before, hence knew my plan well, choosing as my seat of my vigil the old room of Jan Martens, whose murder loomed so great in the rural legends. I felt subtly that the apartment of this ancient victim was best for my purposes. The chamber, measuring about 20 feet square, contained, like the other rooms, some rubbish which had been once furniture. It lay on the second story, on the southeast corner of the house, and had an immense east window and narrow south window, both devoid of panes or shutters. Opposite the large window was an enormous Dutch fireplace with scriptural tiles representing the prodigal son, and opposite the narrow window was a spacious bed built into the wall. As the tree-muffled thunder grew louder, I arranged my plan's details. First, I fastened, side by side, to the ledge of the large window, three rope ladders which I had brought with me. I knew they reached the suitable spot on the grass outside because I had tested them. Then, the three of us dragged from another room a wide four-poster bedstead, crowding it laterally against the window. Having strewn it from fir boughs, all now rested on it with drawn automatics, two relaxing while the third watched. From whatever direction the demon might come, our potential escape was provided. If it came from within the house, we had the window ladders. If from outside, the door and the stairs. We did not think, judging from precedent, that it would pursue us far even at worst. I watched from midnight to 1 o'clock, when, in spite of the sinister house, the unprotected window, and the approaching thunder and lightning, I felt singularly drowsy. I was between my two companions, George Bennett being toward the window, and William Toby toward the fireplace. Bennett was asleep, having apparently felt the same anomalous drowsiness which affected me,
So I designated Toby for the next watch, although even he was nodding. It was curious how intently I had been watching that fireplace. The increasing thunder must have affected my dreams, for in the brief time I slept, there came to me apocalyptic visions. Once I partly awakened, probably because the sleeper toward the window had restlessly flung an arm across my chest, I was not sufficiently awake to see whether Toby was attending to his duties as sentinel, but felt a distinct anxiety on that score. Never before had the presence of evil so poignantly oppressed me. Later, I must have dropped asleep again, for it was out of a phantasmal chaos that my mind leaped when the night grew hideous with shrieks beyond anything in my former experience or imagination. In that shrieking, the inmost soul of human fear and agony clawed hopelessly and insanely at the ebony gates of oblivion. I awoke to red madness and the mockery of diabolism as farther and farther down inconceivable vistas that phobic and crystalline anguish retreated and reverberated. There was no light, but I knew from the empty space at my right that Toby was gone. God alone knew whither. Across my chest still lay the heavy arm of the sleeper at my left. Then came the devastating stroke of lightning which shook the whole mountain, lit the darkest crypts of the hoary grove, and splintered the patriarch of the twisted trees. In the demon flash of a monstrous fireball, the sleeper started up suddenly, while the glare from beyond the window threw his shadow vividly upon the chimney above the fireplace from which my eyes had ever strayed. That I am still alive and sane is a marvel I cannot fathom. I cannot fathom it, for the shadow on that chimney was not that of George Bennett, or of any other human creature, but a blasphemous abnormality from hell's nethermost craters. A nameless, shapeless abomination which no mind could fully grasp, and no pen even partly describe. In another second, I was alone in the accursed mansion, shivering and gibbering. George Bennett and William Toby had left no trace, not even of a struggle. They were never heard of again.
Chapter 2.
A Passer in the Storm.
4 days after that hideous experience in the forest swath mansion, I lay nervously exhausted in my hotel room at Lafert's Corners. I did not remember exactly how I managed to reach the motor car, start it, and slipped unobserved back to the village, for I retain no distinct impression save of wild-armed titan trees, demonic mutterings of thunder, and Charonian shadows athwart the low mounds that dotted and streaked the region. As I shivered and brooded on the casting of that brain-blasting shadow, I knew that I had at last pried out of the earth's supreme horrors one of those nameless blights of outer voids whose faint demon scratchings we sometimes hear on the farthest rim of space, yet from which our own finite visions has given us a merciful immunity. The shadow I had seen, I hardly dared to analyze or identify. Something had lain between me and the window that night, but I shuddered whenever I could not cast off the instinct to classify it. If it had only snarled or bayed or laughed titteringly, even that would have relieved the abysmal hideousness, but it was so silent. It had rested a heavy arm or foreleg on my chest. Obviously, it was organic or had once been organic. Jan Martens, whose room I had invaded, was buried in the graveyard near the mansion. I must find Bennett and Toby, if they lived. Why had it picked them and left me for the last? Drowsiness is so stifling, and dreams are so horrible. I had already decided not to abandon the quest for the lurking fear.
For, in my rash ignorance, it seemed to me that uncertainty was worse than enlightenment, however terrible the latter might prove to be. Accordingly, I resolved in my mind the best course to pursue, whom to select for my confidences in how to track down the thing which had obliterated two men and cast a nightmare shadow. My chief acquaintances at Lefert's Corners had been the affable reporters, of whom several still remained to collect final echoes of the tragedy. It was from these that I determined to choose a colleague, and the more I reflected, the more my preference inclined toward one Arthur Monroe, a dark, lean man of about 35, whose education, taste, intelligence, and temperament all seemed to mark him as one not bound to conventional ideas and experiences. On an afternoon in early September, Arthur Moore listened to my story. I saw from the beginning that he was both interested and sympathetic, and when I had finished, he analyzed and discussed the thing with the great shrewdness and judgment. His advice, moreover, was eminently practical, for he recommended a postponement of operations at the Martens mansion until we might become fortified with more detailed historical and geographical data. On his initiative, we combed the countryside for information regarding the terrible Martens family and discovered a man who possessed a marvelously illuminating ancestral diary. We also talked at length with such of the mountain mongrels as had not fled from the terror and confusion to remoter slopes and arranged to proceed our culminating task, the exhaustive and definitive examination of the mansion in the light of its detailed history, with an equally exhaustive and definitive examination of spots associated with the various tragedies of squatter legend. The results of this examination were not at first very enlightening, although our tabulation of them seemed to reveal a fairly significant trend, namely, that the number of reported horrors was by far the greatest in areas either comparatively near the avoided house or connected with it by stretches of the morbidly overnourished forest. There were, it is true, exceptions. Indeed, the horror which had caught the world's ear had happened in a treeless space, remote alike from the mansion and from any connecting woods. As to the nature and appearance of the lurking fear, nothing could be gained from the sacred and witless shanty dwellers. In the same breath, they called it a snake and a giant, a thunder devil and a bat, a vulture and a walking tree. We did, however, deem ourselves justified in assuming that it was a living organism highly susceptible to electrical storms, and although certain of the stories suggested wings, we believed that its aversion for open spaces made land locomotion a more probable theory. The only thing really incompatible with the latter view was the rapidity with which the creature must have traveled in order to perform all the deeds attributed to it. When we came to know the squatters better, we found them curiously likable in many ways. Simple animals they were, gently descending the evolutionary scale, because of their unfortunate ancestry and stultifying isolation. They feared outsiders, but slowly grew accustomed to us, finally helping vastly when we beat down all the thickets and tore out all of the partitions of the mansion in our search for the lurking fear. When we asked them to help us find Bennett and Toby, they were truly distressed, for they wanted to help us, yet knew that these victims had gone as wholly out of the world as their own missing people, that great numbers of them had actually been killed and removed, just as the wild animals had long been exterminated. We were, of course, thoroughly convinced, and we waited apprehensively for further tragedies to occur. By the middle of October, we were puzzled by our lack of progress. Owing to the clear nights, no demonic aggressions had taken place, and the completeness of our vain searches of house and country almost drove us to regard the lurking fear as a non-material agency.
We feared that the cold weather would come on and halt our explorations, for all agreed that the demon was generally quiet in winter. Thus, there was a kind of haste and desperation in our last daylight canvas of the horror-visited hamlet, a hamlet now deserted because of the squatter's fears. The ill-fated squatter hamlet had borne no name, but had long stood in a sheltered, though treeless, cleft between two elevations called, respectively, Cone Mountain and Maple Hill. It was closer to Maple Hill than Cone Mountain, some of the crude abodes indeed being dugouts in the side of the former eminence. Geographically, it lay about 2 miles northwest of the base of Tempest Mountain, and 3 miles from the oak-girt mansion. Of the distance between the hamlet and the mansion, fully 2 miles and a quarter on the hamlet side was entirely open country, the plain being of fairly level character, save for some of the low, snake-like mounds, and having as vegetation only grass and scattered weeds. Considering this topography, we had finally concluded that the demon must have come by way of Cone Mountain, a wooded southern prolongation of which ran to within a short distance of the westernmost spur of Tempest Mountain. The upheaval of ground we traced conclusively to a landslide from Maple Hill, a tall, lone splintered tree on whose side had been the striking point of the thunderbolt which summoned the fiend. As for the 20th time or more, Arthur Monroe and I minutely went over every inch of the violated village, we were filled with a certain discouragement coupled with vague and novel fears. It was acutely uncanny, even when frightful and uncanny things were common, to encounter so blankly clueless a scene after such overwhelming occurrences. And we moved about beneath the leaden, darkening sky with that tragic, directionless zeal which results from a combined sense of futility and necessity of action. Our care was gravely minute. Every cottage was again entered, every hillside dugout again searched for bodies, every thorny foot of adjacent slope again scanned for dens and caves, but all without result. And yet, as I have said, vague new fears hovered menacingly over us, as if giant bat-winged griffins squatted invisibly on the mountaintops and leered with abaddoned eyes that had looked on transcosmic gulfs. As the afternoon advanced, it became increasingly difficult to see, and we heard the rumble of a thunderstorm gathering over Tempest Mountain. This sound, in such a locality, naturally stirred us, though less than it would have done at night. As it was, we hoped desperately that the storm would last until well after dark, and, with that hope, turned from our aimless hillside searching toward the nearest inhabited hamlet to gather a body of squatters as helpers in the investigation. Timid as they were, a few of the younger men were sufficiently inspired by our protective leadership to promise such help. We had hardly more than turned, however, when there descended such a blinding sheet of torrential rain that shelter became imperative. The extreme, almost nocturnal darkness of the sky caused us to stumble sadly, but guided by the frequent flashes of lightning and by our minute knowledge of the hamlet, we soon reached the least porous cabin of the lot, an heterogeneous combination of logs and boards, whose still existing door and single tiny window both faced Maple Hill. Barring the door after us against the fury of the wind and rain, we put in place the crude window shutter which our frequent searches taught us where to find. It was dismal sitting there on rickety boxes in the pitchy darkness, but we smoked pipes and occasionally flashed our pocket lamps about. Now and then we could see the lightning through the cracks in the wall. The afternoon was so incredibly dark that each flash was extremely vivid. The stormy vigil reminded me shudderingly of my ghastly night on Tempest Mountain. My mind turned to that odd question which kept recurring ever since the nightmare thing had happened, and again I wondered why the demon, approaching the three watchers either from the window or the interior, had begun with the man on each side and left the middleman till the last, when the Titan fireball had scared it away.
Why had it not taken its victims in natural order, with myself second, from whichever direction it had approached? With what matter of far-reaching tentacles did it prey? Or did it know that I was the leader and saved me for a fate worse than that of my companions? In the midst of these reflections, as if dramatically arranged to intensify them, there fell nearby a terrific bolt of lightning, followed by the sound of sliding earth. At the same time, the wolfish wind rose to demonic crescendos of ululation. We were sure that the lone tree on Maple Hill had been struck again, and Monroe rose from his box and went to the tiny window to ascertain the damage. When he took down the shutter, the wind and rain howled deafeningly in, so that I could not hear what he said, but I waited while he leaned out and tried to fathom nature's pandemonium. Gradually, a calming of the wind and dispersal of the unusual darkness told of the storm's passing. I had hoped it would last into the night to help our quest, but a furtive sunbeam from a knothole behind me removed the likelihood of such a thing. Suggesting to Monroe that we had better get some light, even if more showers came, I unbarred and opened the crude door. The ground outside was a singular mass of mud and pools, with fresh heaps of earth from the slight landslide. But I saw nothing to justify the interest which kept my companion silently leaning out of the window. Crossing to where he leaned, I touched his shoulder, but he did not move. Then, as I playfully shook him and turned him around, I felt the strangling tendrils of a cancerous horror whose roots reached into illimitable pasts and fathomless abysms of the night that broods beyond time. For Arthur Monroe was dead, and on what remained of his chewed and gouged head there was no longer a face.
Chapter 3. What the Red Glare Meant. On the tempest-racked night of November 8th, 1921, with a lantern which cast charnel shadows, I stood digging alone and idiotically in the grave of Jan Martens. I had begun to dig in the afternoon because a thunderstorm was brewing, and now that it was dark and the storm had burst above the maniacally thick foliage, I was glad. I believed that my mind was partly unhinged by events since August 5th. The demon shadow in the mansion, the general strain and disappointment, and the thing that occurred at the hamlet in an October storm. After that thing had dug a grave for those whose death I could not understand. I knew that others could not understand either, so let them think Arthur Monroe had wandered away. They searched, but found nothing. The squatters might have understood, but I dared not frighten them more. I myself seemed strangely callous. That shock at the mansion had done something to my brain, and I could think only of the quest for a horror now grown to cataclysmic stature in my imagination. A quest which the fate of Arthur Monroe made me vow to keep silent and solitary. The scene of my excavations would alone have been enough to unnerve any ordinary man. Baleful primal trees of unholy size, age, and grotesqueness leered above me like the pillars of some hellish druidic temple, muffling the thunder, hushing the clawing wind, and admitting but little rain. Beyond the scarred trunks in the background, illuminated by faint flashes of filtered lightning, rose the damp, ivied stones of the deserted mansion. While somewhat nearer was the abandoned Dutch garden, whose walks and beds were polluted by a white fungus foetid, overnourished vegetation that never saw full daylight. And nearest of all was the graveyard, where deformed trees tossed insane branches as their roots displaced on hallowed slabs and sucked venom from what lay below. Now and then, beneath the brown pall of leaves that rotted and festered in the antediluvian forest darkness, I could trace the sinister outlines of some of those low mounds which characterized the lightning-pierced region. History had led me to this archaic grave, History, indeed, was all I had after everything else ended in mocking Satanism. I now believed that the lurking fear was no material thing, but a wolf-fanged ghost that rode the midnight lightning. And I believed, because of the masses of local tradition, I had unearthed in my search with Arthur Monroe that the ghost was that of Jan Martens, who died in 1762. That is why I was digging idiotically in his grave. The Martens mansion was built in 1670 by Garrett Martens, a wealthy New Amsterdam merchant who disliked the changing order under British rule and had constructed this magnificent domicile on a remote woodland summit whose untrodden solitude and unusual scenery pleased him. The only substantial disappointment encountered in this site was that which concerned the prevalence of violent thunderstorms in summer. When selecting the hill and building the mansion, Mynheer Martens had laid these frequent natural outbursts to some peculiarity of the year. But in time he perceived that the locality was especially liable to such phenomenon. At length, having found these storms injurious to his health, he fitted up a cellar into which he could retreat from their wildest pandemonium. Of Garrett Martens's descendants, less is known than of himself, since they were all reared in hatred of the English civilization and trained to shun such of the colonists as accepted it. Their life was exceedingly secluded, and people declared that their isolation had made them heavy of speech and comprehension. In appearance, all were marked by a peculiar inherited dissimilarity of eyes, one generally being blue, the other brown. Their social contacts grew fewer and fewer, till at last they took to intermarrying with the numerous menial class about the estate. Many of the crowded family degenerated, moved across the valley, and merged with the mongrel population, which was later to produce the pitiful squatters. The rest had stuck sullenly to their ancestral mansion, becoming more and more clannish and taciturn, yet developing a nervous responsiveness to the frequent thunderstorms. Most of this information reached the outside world through young Jan Martens, who, from some kind of restlessness, joined the colonial army when news of the Albany Convention reached Tempest Mountain. He was the first of Garrett's descendants to see much of the world, and when he returned in 1760 after 6 years of campaigning, he was hated as an outsider by his father, uncles, and brothers, in spite of his dissimilar Martens eyes. No longer could he share the peculiarities and prejudices of the Martenses, while the very mountain thunderstorms failed to intoxicate him as they had before. Instead, his surroundings depressed him, and he frequently wrote to a friend in Albany of plans to leave the paternal roof. In the spring of 1763, Jonathan Guilford, the Albany friend of Jan Martens, became worried by his correspondent's silence, especially in view of the conditions and quarrels at the Martens mansion. Determined to visit Jan in person, he went into the mountains on horseback. His diary states that he reached Tempest Mountain on September 20th, finding the mansion in great decrepitude. The sullen, odd-eyed Martenses, whose unclean animal aspect shocked him, told him, in broken gutturals, that Jan was dead. He had, they insisted, been struck by lightning the autumn before, and now lay buried behind the neglected sunken gardens. They showed the visitor the grave, barren and devoid of markers. Something in the Martens' manner gave Gifford a feeling of repulsion and suspicion, and a week later he returned with spade and mattock to explore the sepulchral spot. He found what he expected, a skull crushed cruelly as if by savage blows. So, returning to Albany, he openly charged the Martenses with the murder of their kinsman. Legal evidence was lacking, but the story spread rapidly around the countryside. And from that time the Martenses were ostracized by the world. No one would deal with them, and their distant manor was shunned as an accursed place. Somehow they managed to live on independently by the products of their estate, for occasional lights glimpsed from faraway hills attested to their continued presence. These lights were seen as late as 1810, but toward the last they became very infrequent. Meanwhile, there grew up about the mansion and the mountain a body of diabolic legendary. The place was avoided with doubled assiduousness, and invested with every whispered myth tradition could supply. It remained unvisited till 1816, when the continued absence of lights was noticed by the squatters. At that time, a party made investigations, finding the house deserted and partly in ruins. There were no skeletons about, so that departure, rather than death, was inferred. The clan seemed to have left several years before, and impoverished penthouses showed how numerous it had grown prior to its migration. Its cultural level had fallen very low, as proved by decaying furniture and scattered silverware, which must have been abandoned when its owners left. But though the dreaded Martenses were gone, the fear of the haunted house continued, and grew very acute when new and strange stories arose among the mountain decedents. There it stood, deserted, feared, and linked with the vengeful ghost of Jan Martens. There it still stood on the night I dug in Jan Martens's grave. I have described my protracted digging as idiotic, and such it indeed was in object and method. The coffin of Jan Martens had soon been unearthed. It now only held dust and nitre. But in my fury to exhume his ghost, I delved irrationally and clumsily down beneath where he had lain. God knows what I expected to find. I only felt that I was digging in the grave of a man whose ghost stalked by night. It is impossible to say what monstrous depth I had attained when my spade, and soon my feet, broke through the ground beneath. The event, under the circumstances, was tremendous, for in the existence of a subterranean space here, my mad theories had terrible confirmation. My slight fall had extinguished the lantern, but I produced an electric pocket lamp and viewed the small horizontal tunnel which it led away indefinitely in both directions. It was amply large enough for a man to wiggle through, and though no sane person would have tried it at the time, I forgot danger, reason, and cleanliness in my single-minded fever to unearth the lurking fear. Choosing the direction toward the house, I scrambled recklessly into the narrow burrow, squirming ahead blindly and rapidly, and flashing but seldom the lamp I kept before me. What language can describe the spectacle of a man lost in infinitely abysmal earth, pawing, twisting, wheezing, scrambling madly through sunken convolutions of immemorial blackness without an idea of time, safety, direction, or definite object? There is something hideous in it, but that is what I did. I did it for so long that life faded to a far memory, and I became one with the moles and grubs of nighted depths. Indeed, it was only by accident that, after interminable writhings, I jarred my forgotten electric lamp alight so that it shone eerily along the burrow of caked loam that stretched and curved ahead. I had been scrambling in this way for some time, so that my battery had burned very low, when the passage suddenly inclined sharply upward, altering my mode of progress. And as I raised my glance, it was without preparation that I saw, glistening in the distance, two demonic reflections of my expiring lamp. Two reflections glowing with a baneful and unmistakable effulgence and provoking maddeningly nebulous memories. I stopped automatically. Though lacking the brain to retreat, the eyes approached, yet of the thing that bore them I could distinguish only a claw. But what a claw! Then, far overhead, I heard a faint crashing, which I recognized. It was the wild thunder of the mountain, raised to hysteric fury. I must have been crawling upward for some time, so that the surface was quite near. And as the muffled thunder clattered, those eyes still stared with vacuous viciousness. Thank God I did not know then what it was, else I should have died.
But I was saved by the very thunder that had summoned it, for, after a hideous wait, there burst from the unseen outside sky one of those frequent mountainward bolts whose aftermath I had noticed here and there as gnashes of disturbed earth and fulgurites of various sizes. With cyclopean rage, it tore through the soil above that damnable pit, blinding and deafening me, yet not wholly reducing me to a coma. In the chaos of sliding, shifting earth, I clawed and floundered helplessly until the rain on my head steadied me, and I saw that I had come to the surface in a familiar spot, a steep, unforested place on the southwest slope of the mountain. Recurrent sheet lightnings illumined the tumbled ground and the remains of the curious low hummock, which had stretched down from the wooded higher slope. But there was nothing in the chaos to show my place of egress from the lethal catacomb. My brain was as great a chaos as the earth, and as a distant red glare burst on the landscape from the south, I hardly realized the horror I had been through. But when 2 days later the squatters told me what the red glare meant, I felt more horror than that which the mold burrow and the claw and eyes had given. More horror because of the overwhelming implications. In a hamlet, 20 miles away, an orgy of fear had followed the bolt which brought me above ground, and a nameless thing had dropped from an overhanging tree into a weak-roofed cabin. It had done a deed, but the squatters had fired the cabin in frenzy before it could escape. It had been doing that deed at that very moment the earth caved in on the thing with a claw and eyes.
Chapter 4. The Horror in the Eyes. There can be nothing normal in the mind of one who, knowing what I knew of the horrors of Tempest Mountain, would seek alone for the fear that lurked there. That at least two of the fear's embodiments were destroyed, formed but a slight guarantee of mental and physical safety in this Acheron of multiform diabolism. Yet I continued my quest with even greater zeal, as events and revelations became more monstrous. When, 2 days after my fretful crawl through that crypt of the eyes and claw, I learned that a thing had malignantly hovered 20 miles away at the same instant the eyes were glaring at me, I experienced virtual convulsions of fright. But that fright was so mixed with wonder and alluring grotesqueness that it was almost a pleasant sensation. Sometimes in the throes of a nightmare, when unseen powers whirl one over the roofs of strange dead cities toward the grinning chasm of Nis, it is a relief and even a delight to shriek wildly and throw oneself voluntarily along the hideous vortex of dream doom into whatever bottomless gulf you may yawn. And so it was with the waking nightmare of Tempest Mountain. The discovery that two monsters had haunted the spot gave me ultimately a mad craving to plunge into the very earth of the accursed region and with bare hands dig out the death that leered from every inch of the poisonous soul. As soon as possible, I visited the grave of Jan Martens and dug vainly where I had dug before. Some extensive cave-in had obliterated all trace of the underground passage, while the rain had washed so much earth back into the excavation that I could not tell how deeply I had dug the other day. I likewise made a difficult trip to the distant hamlet where the death creature had been burnt and was little repaid for my trouble. In the ashes of the fateful cabin I found several bones, but apparently none of the monsters. The squatters said the thing had had only one victim, but in this I judged them inaccurate, since beside the complete skull of a human being, there was another bony fragment which seemed certainly to have belonged to a human skull at some time. Though the rapid drop of the monster had been seen, no one could say just what the creature was like. Those who had glimpsed it simply called it a devil. Examining the great tree where it had lurked, I could discern no distinctive marks.
I tried to find some trail into the Black Forest, but on this occasion could not stand the sight of those morbidly large boles, or of those vast serpent-like roots that twisted so malevolently before they sank into the earth. My next step was to re-examine with microscopic care the deserted hamlet where death had come most abundantly, and where Arthur Monroe had seen something he never lived to describe. Though my vain previous searches had been exceedingly minute, I now had new data to test, for my horrible grave crawl convinced me that at least one of the phases of the monstrosity had been an underground creature. This time, on the 14th of November, my quest concerned itself mostly with the slopes of Cone Mountain and Maple Hill, where they overlook the unfortunate hamlet, and I gave particular attention to the loose earth of the landslide region on the latter eminence. The afternoon of my search brought nothing to light, and dusk came as I stood on Maple Hill, looking down at the hamlet and across the valley to Tempest Mountain. There had been a gorgeous sunset, and now the moon came up, nearly full, and shedding a silver flood over the plain, the distant mountainside, and the curious low mounds that rose here and there. It was a peaceful, Arcadian scene, but knowing what it hid, I hated it. I hated the mocking moon, the hypocritical plain, the festering mountain, and those sinister mounds. Everything seemed to me tainted with a loathsome contagion, and inspired by a noxious alliance with distorted hidden powers. Presently, as I gazed abstractly at the moonlit panorama, my eye became attracted by something singular in nature and arrangement of a certain topographical element. Without having any exact idea of geology, I had, from the first, been interested in the odd mounds and hummocks of the region. I had noticed that they were pretty widely distributed around Tempest Mountain, though less numerous on the plain than near the hilltop itself, where prehistoric glaciation had doubtless found feebler opposition to its striking and fantastic caprices. Now, in the light of that low moon which cast long, weird shadows, it struck me forcibly that the various points and lines of the mound system had a peculiar relation to the summit of Tempest Mountain. That summit was undeniably a center from which the lines or rows of points radiated indefinitely and irregularly, as if the unwholesome Martens mansion had thrown visible tentacles of terror. The idea of such tentacles gave me an unexplained thrill, and I stopped to analyze my reason for believing these mounds glacial phenomena. The more I analyzed, the less I believed, and against my newly opened mind there began to beat grotesque and horrible analogies based on superficial aspects and upon my experience beneath the earth. Before I knew it, I was uttering frenzied and disjointed words to myself. My God! Molehills! That damn place must be honeycombed. How many? That night at the mansion, they took Bennett and Toby first, on each side of us. Then I was digging frantically into the mound which had stretched nearest me, digging desperately, shiveringly, but almost jubilantly, digging, and at last shrieking aloud with some unplaced emotion, as I came upon a tunnel or burrow just like the one through which I had crawled on that other demonic night. After that I recall running, spade in hand, a hideous run across moonlit and mound-marked meadows, and through diseased, precipitous abysses of haunted hillside forest, leaping, screaming, panting, bounding toward the terrible Martens mansion. I recall digging unreasoningly in all parts of the briar-choked cellar, digging to find the core and center of that malignant universe of mounds. And then I recall how I laughed when I stumbled on the passageway, the hole at the base of the old chimney where the thick weeds grew and cast queer shadows in the light of the lone candle I had happened to have with me. What still remained down in that hell hive
lurking and waiting for the thunder to rouse it? I did not know. Two had been killed. Perhaps that had finished it. But still, there remained that burning determination to reach the innermost secret of the fear, which I had once more come to deem definite, material, and organic. My indecisive speculation whether to explore the passage alone and immediately with my pocket light, or to try to assemble a band of squatters for the crest, was interrupted after a time by a sudden rush of wind from outside, which blew out the candle and left me in stark blackness. The moon no longer shone through the chinks and apertures above me, and with a sense of fateful alarm I heard the sinister and significant rumble of approaching thunder. Confusion of associated ideas possessed my brain, leading me to grope back toward the farthest corner of the cellar. My eyes, however, never turned away from the horrible opening at the base of the chimney, and I began to get glimpses of the crumbling bricks and unhealthy weeds as faint glows of lightning penetrated the woods outside and illuminated the chinks in the upper wall. Every second, I was consumed with a mixture of fear and curiosity. What would this storm call forth, or was there anything left for it to call? Guided by a lightning flash, I settled myself down behind a dense clump of vegetation, through which I could see the opening without being seen. If heaven is merciful, it will some day efface from my consciousness the sight that I saw and let me live my last years in peace. I cannot sleep at night now and have to take opiates when it thunders. The thing came abruptly and unannounced, a demon rat-like scurrying from pits remote and unimaginable, a hellish panting and stifled grunting. And then from that opening beneath the chimney, a burst of multitudinous and leprous life, a loathsome night-spawned flood of organic corruption, more devastatingly hideous than the blackest conjurations of mortal madness and morbidity. Seething, stewing, surging, bubbling like serpent slime, it rolled up and out of that yawning hole, spreading like a septic contagion, and streaming from the cellar at every point of egress, streaming out to scatter through the accursed midnight forests and strew fear, madness, and death. God knows how many there were. There must have been thousands. To see the stream of them in that faint, intermittent lightning was shocking. When they had thinned out enough to be glimpsed as separate organisms, I saw that they were dwarfed, deformed hairy devils or apes, monstrous and diabolical caricatures of the monkey tribe. They were so hideously silent. There was hardly a squeal when one of the last stragglers turned with the skill of long practice to make a meal in accustomed fashion on a weaker companion. Others snapped up what it left and ate with a slavering relish. Then, in spite of my days of fright and disgust, my morbid curiosity triumphed, and as the last of the monstrosities oozed up alone from that nether world of unknown nightmare, I drew my automatic pistol and shot it under cover of thunder. Shrieking, slithering torrential shadows of red viscous madness, chasing one another through endless, ensanguined corridors of purple fulgurous sky, formless phantasms, and kaleidoscopic mutations of a ghoulish, remembered scene. Forests of monstrous, over-nourished oaks, with serpent roots twisting and sucking unnameable juices from an earth verminous with millions of cannibal devils. Mound-like tentacles, groping from underneath nuclei of populous perversions. Insane lightning over malignant ivied walls, and demon arcades choked with fungus vegetation. Heaven be thanked for the instinct which led me unconscious to places where men dwell, to the peaceful village that slept under the calm stars of clearing skies. I had recovered enough in a week to send Albany for a gang of men to blow up the Martens mansion and the entire top of Tempest Mountain with dynamite, stop up all the undiscoverable mound burrows, and destroy certain overnourished trees whose very existence seemed an insult to sanity.
I could sleep a little after they had done this. But true rest will never come as long as I remember that nameless secret of that lurking fear. The thing will haunt me. For who can say the extermination is complete and that analogous phenomenon do not exist all over the world? Who can, with my knowledge, think of the Earth's unknown caverns without a nightmare dread of future possibilities? I cannot see a well or a subway entrance without shuddering. Why cannot the doctors give me something to make me sleep or truly calm my brain when it thunders? What I saw in the glow of my flashlight after I shot the unspeakable, straggling object was so simple that almost a minute elapsed before I understood and went delirious. The object was nauseous, a filthy, whitish gorilla thing with sharp yellow fangs and matted fur. It was the ultimate product of mammalian degeneration, the frightful outcome of isolated spawning, multiplication, and cannibal nutrition above and below the ground, the embodiment of all the snarling chaos and grinning fear that lurked behind life. It looked at me as it died, and its eyes had the same odd quality that marked those other eyes which had stared at me underground and excited cloudy recollections. One eye was blue, the other brown. They were the dissimilar Martens eyes of the old legends. And I knew in one undulating cataclysm of voiceless horror what had become of that vanished family, the terrible and thunder-crazed House of Martens.
The Shunned House. From even the greatest of horrors, irony is seldom absent. Sometimes it enters directly into the composition of the events, while sometimes it relates only to their fortuitous position among persons and places. The latter sort is splendidly exemplified by a case in the ancient city of Providence, where in the late 40s, Edgar Allan Poe used to sojourn often during his unsuccessful wooing of the gifted poetess Mrs. Whitman. Poe generally stopped at the Mansion House in Benefit Street, the renamed Golden Ball Inn, whose roof has sheltered Washington, Jefferson, and Lafayette, and his favorite walk led northward along the same street to Mrs. Whitman's home and the neighboring hillside churchyard of St. John's, whose hidden expanse of 18th-century gravestones had for him a peculiar fascination. Now, this irony is this. In this walk, so many times repeated, the world's greatest master of the terrible and the bizarre was so obliged to pass a particular house on the eastern side of the street, a dingy, antiquated structure perched on the abruptly rising side hill, with a great unkempt yard dating from a time when the region was partly open country. It does not appear that he ever wrote or spoke of it, nor is there any evidence that he even noticed it. And yet that house, to the two persons in possession of certain information, equals or outranks in horror the wildest fantasy of the genius who so often passed it unknowingly and stands starkly leering as a symbol of all that is unutterably hideous. The house was, and for that matter still is, of a kind to attract the attention of the curious. Originally a farm or semi-farm building, it followed the average New England colonial lines of the middle 18th century, the prosperous peak-roofed sort, with two stories and a dormerless attic, and with a Georgian doorway and interior paneling dictated by the progress of taste at the time. It faced south, with one gable end buried to the lower windows in the eastward rising hill, and the other exposed to the foundations toward the street. Its construction, over a century and a half ago, had followed the grading and straightening of the road in that especial vicinity, for Benefit Street, at first called Back Street, was laid out as a lane winding amongst the graveyards of the first settlers, and straightened only when the removal of the bodies to the north burial ground made it decently possible to cut through the old family plots. At the start, the western wall had lain some 20 feet up a precipitous lawn from the roadway, but a widening of the street at about the time of the Revolution sheared off most of the intervening space, exposing the foundation so that a brick basement wall had to be made, giving the deep cellar a street frontage with door and two windows above ground, close to the new line of public travel. When the sidewalk was laid out a century ago, the last of the intervening space was removed, and Poe, in his walks, must have seen only a sheer ascent of dull gray brick flush with the sidewalk and surmounted at a height of 10 feet by the antique shingled bulk of the house proper. The farm-like grounds extended back very deeply up the hill, almost to Wheaton Street. The space south of the house, abutting on Benefit Street, was, of course, greatly above the existing sidewalk level, forming a terrace bounded by a high bank wall of damp, mossy stone, pierced by a steep flight of narrow steps which led inward between canyon-like surfaces to the upper regions of mangy lawn, roomy brick walls, and neglected gardens whose dismantled cement urns, rusted kettles fallen from tripods of knotty sticks, and similar paraphernalia set off the weather-beaten front door from its broken fanlight, rotting Ionic pilasters, and wormy triangular pediment. What I heard in my youth about the shunned house was merely that people died there in alarmingly great numbers. That, I was told, was why the original owners had moved out some 20 years after building the place. It was plainly unhealthy, perhaps because of the dampness and fungus growth in the cellar, the general sickish smell, the drafts of the hallways, or the quality of the well and pump water. These things were bad enough, and these were all that gained belief among the persons whom I knew. Only the notebooks of my antiquarian uncle, Dr. Elihu Whipple, revealed to me at length the darker, vaguer surmises which formed an undercurrent of folklore among old-time servants and humble folk, surmises which never traveled far and which were largely forgotten, when Providence grew to be a metropolis with a shifting modern population. The general fact is that the house was never regarded by the solid part of the community as, in any real sense, haunted. There were no widespread tales of rattling chains, cold currents of air, extinguished lights, or faces at the window. Extremists sometimes said the house was unlucky, but that is as far as they went. What was really beyond dispute is that a frightful proportion of persons died there, or more accurately, had died there, since after some peculiar happenings over 60 years ago, the building had become deserted through the sheer impossibility of renting it. These persons were not all cut off suddenly by one cause. Rather, did it seem that their vitality was insidiously sapped, so that each one died the sooner from whatever tendency to weakness he may have naturally had. And those who did not die displayed in varying degree a type of anemia or consumption, and sometimes a decline of the mental faculties, which spoke ill for the salubriousness of the building. Neighboring houses, it must be added, seemed entirely free of the noxious quality. This much I knew before my insistent questioning led my uncle to show me the notes which finally embarked us both on our hideous investigation. In my childhood, the shunned house was vacant, with barren, gnarled, and terrible old trees, long, queerly pale grass, and nightmarishly misshapen weeds in the high terraced yards where birds never lingered. We boys used to overrun the place, and I can still recall my youthful terror not only at the morbid strangeness of this sinister vegetation, but at the eldritch atmosphere and odor of the dilapidated house, whose unlocked front door was often entered in quest of shutters. The small paned windows were largely broken, and a nameless air of desolation hung around the precarious paneling, Shaky interior shutters, peeling wallpaper, falling plaster, rickety staircases, and such fragments of battered furniture as still remained. The dust and cobwebs added their touch of the fearful, and brave, indeed, was the boy who would voluntarily ascend the ladder to the attic, a vast, raftered length lighted only by small blinking windows in the gable ends, and filled with a massed wreckage of chests, chairs, and spinning wheels, which infinite years of deposit had shrouded and festooned into monstrous and hellish shapes. But, after all, the attic was not the most terrible part of the house. It was the dank, humid cellar, which somehow exerted the strongest repulsion on us, even though it was wholly above ground on the street side, with only a thin door and window-pierced brick wall to separate it from the busy sidewalk. We scarcely knew whether to haunt it in spectral fascination or to shun it for the sake of our souls and our sanity. For one thing, the bad odor of the house was strongest there, and for another thing, we did not like the white fungus growth which occasionally sprang up in rainy summer weather from the hard earth floor. Those fungi, grotesquely like the vegetation in the yard outside, were truly horrible in their outlines, detestable parodies of toadstools and Indian pipes, whose like we had never seen in any other situation. They rotted quickly, and at one stage became slightly phosphorescent, so that nocturnal passers-by sometimes spoke of witch fires glowing behind the broken panes of the photo-spreading windows. We never, even in our wildest Halloween moods, visited this cellar by night. But in some of our daytime visits, could detect the phosphorescence, especially when the day was dark and wet. There was also a subtler thing we often thought we detected. A very strange thing which was, however, merely suggestive at most. I refer to the sort of cloudy whitish pattern on the dirt floor. A vague shifting deposit of mold or nitre, which we sometimes thought we could trace amidst the sparse fungus growths near the huge fireplace of the basement kitchen. Once in a while, it struck us that this patch bore an uncanny resemblance to a doubled-up human figure, though generally no such kinship existed, and often there was no whitish deposit whatever. On a certain rainy afternoon, when this illusion seemed phenomenally strong, and when, in addition, I had fancied I glimpsed a kind of thin, yellowish, shimmering exhalation rising from the nitrous pattern toward the yawning fireplace, I spoke to my uncle about the matter. He smiled at this odd conceit, but it seemed that his smile was tinged with reminiscence. Later I heard that a similar notion entered into some of the wild ancient tales of the common folk, a notion, likewise alluding to ghoulish, wolfish shapes, taken by smoke from the great chimney, and queer contours assumed by certain of the sinuous tree roots that thrust their way into the cellar through the loose foundation stones. Not until my adult years did my uncle set before me the notes and data which he had collected concerning the shunned house. Dr. Whipple was a sane, conservative physician of the old school, and for all his interest in the place was not eager to encourage young thoughts toward the abnormal. His own view, postulating simply a building and location of markedly unsanitary qualities, had nothing to do with abnormality, but he realized that the very picturesqueness which aroused his own interest would, in a boy's fanciful mind, take on all manner of gruesome, imaginative associations. The doctor was a bachelor, a white-haired, clean-shaven, old-fashioned gentleman, and a local historian of note who had often broke a lance with such controversial guardians of tradition as Sidney S. Ryder and Thomas W. Bicknell. He lived with one manservant in a Georgian homestead with knocker and iron-railed steps, balanced eerily on a steep ascent of North Court Street, beside the ancient brick court and colony house where his grandfather, a cousin of that celebrated privateersman, Captain Wimple, who burnt His Majesty's armed schooner Gaspé in 1772, had voted in the legislature on May 4, 1776, for the independence of the Rhode Island colony. Around him, in the damp, low-ceiled library with the musty white paneling, heavy carved over mantel, and small-paned, vine-shaded windows were the relics and records of his ancient family, among which were many dubious allusions to the Shun House in Benefit Street. That pest spot lies not far distant, for Benefit runs ledgewise just above the courthouse along the precipitous hill up which the first settlement climbed. When, in the end, my insistent pestering and maturing years evoked from my uncle the hoarded lore I sought, there lay before me a strange enough chronicle. A long-winded, statistical, and drearily genealogical, as some of the matter was, there reigned through it a continuous thread of brooding, tenacious horror, and preternatural malevolence which impressed me even more than it had impressed the good doctor. Separate events fitted together uncannily, and seemingly irrelevant details held minds of hideous possibilities. A new and burning curiosity grew in me, compared to which my boyish curiosity was feeble and inchoate. The first revelation led to an exhaustive research, and finally to that shuddering quest which proved so disastrous to myself and mine. For at last, my uncle insisted on joining the search I had commenced, and after a certain night in that house, he did not come away with me. I am lonely without that gentle soul, whose long years were filled only with honor, virtue, good taste, benevolence, and learning. I have reared a marble urn to his memory in St. John's Churchyard, the place that Poe loved, the hidden grove of giant willows on the hill, where tombs and headstones huddled quietly between the hoary bulk of the church and the houses and bank walls of Benefit Street. The history of the house, opening amidst a maze of dates, revealed no trace of the sinister, either about its construction or about the preposterous and honorable family who built it. Yet, from the first attaint of calamity, soon increased to boding significance, was apparent. My uncle's carefully compiled record began with the building of the structure in 1763 and followed the theme with an unusual amount of detail. The shunned house, it seems, was first inhabited by William Harris and his wife, Roby Dexter, with their children, Elkanah, born in 1755, Abigail, born in 1757, William Jr., born in 1759, and Ruth, born in 1761. Harris was a substantial merchant and seaman in the West India trade, connected with the firm of Obadiah Brown and his nephews. After Brown's death in 1761, the new firm of Nicholas Brown and Company made him master of the brig Prudence, Providence built, of 120 tons, thus enabling him to erect the new homestead he had desired ever since his marriage. The site he had chosen, a recently straightened part of the new and fashionable back street, which ran along the side of the hill above crowded Cheapside, was all that could be wished, and the building did justice to the location. It was the best that moderate means could afford, and Harris hastened to move in before the birth of a fifth child, which the family expected. That child, a boy, came in December, but was stillborn. Nor was any child to be born alive in that house for a century and a half. The next April sickness occurred among the children, and Abigail and Ruth died before the month was over. Dr. Job Ives diagnosed the trouble as some infantile fever, though others declared it was more of a mere wasting away or decline. It seemed, in any event, to be contagious, for Hannah Bowen, one of the two servants, died of it in the following June. Eli Ladison, the other servant, constantly complained of weakness, and would have returned to his father's farm in Rehoboth, but for a sudden attachment for Mayadabel Pierce, who was hired to succeed Hannah. He died the next year, a sad year indeed, since it marked the death of William Harris himself, enfeebled as he was by the climate of Martinique, where his occupation had kept him for considerable periods during the preceding decade. The widowed Roby Harris never recovered from the shock of her husband's death, and the passing of her firstborn, Elkanah, 2 years later, was the final blow to her reason. In 1768, she fell victim to a mild form of insanity and was thereafter confined to the upper part of the house, her elder maiden sister, Mercy Dexter, having moved in to take charge of the family. Mercy was a plain, raw-boned woman of great strength, but her health visibly declined from the time of her advent. She was greatly devoted to her unfortunate sister and had an especial affection for her only surviving nephew, William, who had, from a sturdy infant, become a sickly, spindling lad. In this year, the servant, Maida Bell, died, and the other servant, Preserved Smith, left without coherent explanation. Or at least, with only some wild tales and a complaint that he disliked the smell of the place. For a time, Mercy could secure no more help, since the 7 deaths and case of madness, all occurring within 5 years' space, had begun to set in motion the body of fireside rumor which later became so bizarre. Ultimately, however, she obtained new servants from out of town. Anne White, a morose woman from that part of North Kingstown, now set off as the township of Exeter, and a capable Boston man named Zenas Lowe. It was Anne White who first gave definitive shape to the sinister idle talk. Mercy should have known better than to hire anyone from Nooseneck Hill country, for that remote bit of backwoods was then, as now, a seat of the most uncomfortable superstitions. As lately as 1892, an Exeter community exhumed a dead body and ceremoniously burnt its heart in order to prevent certain alleged visitations injurious to the public health and peace, and one may imagine the point of view of the same section in 1768. Anne's tongue was perniciously active, and within a few months Mercy discharged her, filling her place with a faithful and amiable Amazon from Newport, Maria Robbins. While poor Roby Harris, in her madness, gave voice to dreams and imaginings of the most hideous sort, at times her screams became insupportable, and for long periods she would utter shrieking horrors, which necessitated her son's temporary residence with his cousin, Peleg Harris, in Presbyterian Lane near the new college building. The boy would seem to improve after these visits, and had Mercy been as wise as she was well-meaning, she would have let him live permanently with Peleg. Just what Miss Harris cried out in her fits of violence, tradition hesitates to say, or rather present such extravagant accounts that they nullify themselves through sheer absurdity. Certainly, it sounds absurd to hear that a woman educated only in the rudiments of French often shouted for hours in a coarse and idiomatic form of that language, or that the same person, alone and guarded, complained wildly of a staring thing which bit and chewed at her. In 1772, the servant Zenas died, and when Mrs. Harris heard of it, she laughed with a shockingly delight utterly foreign to her. The next year, she herself died, and was laid to rest in the north burial ground beside her husband. Upon the outbreak of trouble with Great Britain in 1775, William Harris, despite his scant 16 years and feeble constitution, managed to enlist in the Army of Observation under General Greene, and from that time on enjoyed a steady rise in health and prestige. In 1780, as a captain in Rhode Island forces in New Jersey under Colonel Angell, he met and married Phoebe Hetfield of Elizabethtown, whom he brought to Providence upon his honorable discharge in the following year. The young soldier's return was not a thing of unmitigated happiness. The house, and it's true, was still in good condition, and the street had been widened and changed in name from Back Street to Benefit Street. But Mercy Dexter's once robust frame had undergone a sad and curious decay, so that she was now a stooped and pathetic figure with hollow voice and disconcerting pallor. qualities shared to a singular degree by the one remaining servant, Maria. In the autumn of 1872, Phoebe Harris gave birth to a stillborn daughter, and on the 15th of the next May, Mercy Dexter took leave of a useful, austere, and virtuous life. William Harris, at last thoroughly convinced of the radically unhealthful nature of his abode, now took steps toward quitting it and closing it forever. Securing temporary quarters for himself and his wife at the newly opened Golden Ball Inn, he arranged for the building of a new and finer house in Westminster Street, in the growing part of the town across the Great Bridge. There, in 1785, his son Duty was born, and there the family dwelt till the encroachments of commerce drove them back across the river and over the hill to Angel Hill, in the new East Side residence district, where the late Archer Harris built his sumptuous but hideous French-roofed mansion in 1876. William and Phoebe both succumbed to the yellow fever epidemic of 1797, but Duty was brought up by his cousin, Rathbone Harris, Peleg's son. Rathbone was a practical man and rented the Benefit Street house despite William's wish to keep it vacant. He considered it an obligation to his ward to make the most of all the boy's property, nor did he concern himself with the deaths and illnesses which caused so many changes of tenants, or the steadily growing aversion with which the house was generally regarded. It is likely that he only felt vexation when, in 1804, the town council ordered him to fumigate the place with sulfur, tar, and gum camphor on account of the much-discussed deaths of four persons, presumably caused by the then-diminishing fever epidemic. They said the place had a febrile smell. Duty himself thought little of the house, for he grew up to be a privateersman and served with distinction on the Vigilant under Captain Cahoon in the War of 1812. He returned unharmed, married in 1814, and became a father on that memorable night of September 23rd, 1815, when a great gale drove the waters of the bay over half the town and floated a tall sloop well up Westminster Street so that its masts almost tapped the Harris windows in symbolic information that the new boy, Welcome, was a seaman's son. Welcome did not survive his father, but lived to perish gloriously at Fredericksburg in 1862. Neither he nor his son Archer knew of the shunned house as other than a nuisance almost impossible to rent, perhaps on account of the mustiness and sickly odor of unkept old age. Indeed, it was never rented, after a series of deaths culminating in 1861, which the excitement of the war tended to throw into obscurity. Carrington Harris, last of the male line, knew it only as a deserted and somewhat picturesque center of legend until I told him my experience. He had meant to tear it down and build an apartment house on the site, but after my account decided to let it stand, install plumbing, and rent it. Nor has he yet had any difficulty in obtaining tenants. The horror is gone. It may well be imagined how powerfully I was affected by the annals of the Harrises. In this continuous record, there seemed to be to brood a persistent evil beyond anything in nature as I had known, an evil clearly connected with the house and not with the family. This impression was confirmed by my uncle's less systemic array of miscellaneous data, legends transcribed from servant gossip, cuttings from the papers, copies of death certificates by fellow physicians, and the like. All of this material I cannot hope to give, for my uncle was a tireless antiquarian and very deeply interested in the shunned house. But I may refer to several dominant points which earned notice by their recurrence through many reports from diverse sources. For example, the servant gossip was practically unanimous in attributing to the fungus and malodorous cellar of the house a vast supremacy in evil influence. There had been servants, Anne White especially, who would not use the cellar kitchen, and at least three well-defined legends bore upon the queer quasi-human or diabolic outlines assumed by tree roots and patches of mold in that region. These latter narratives interested me profoundly on account of what I had seen in my boyhood, but I felt most of the significance had in each case been largely obscured by additions from the common stock of local ghost lore. Anne White, with her Exeter superstition, had promulgated the most extravagant and at the same time most consistent tale, alleging that there must lie buried beneath the house one of those vampires, the dead who retain their bodily form and live on the blood or breath of the living, whose hideous legions send their preying shapes or spirits abroad by night. To destroy a vampire, one must, as grandmothers say, exhume it and burn its heart, or at least drive a stake through that organ, and Anne's dogged insistence on a search under the cellar had been prominent in bringing about her discharge. Her tales, however, commanded a wide audience, and were the more readily accepted because the house indeed stood on land once used for burial purposes. To me, their interest depended less on this circumstance than on the peculiarly appropriated way in which they dovetailed with certain other things. The complaint of the departing servant preserved Smith, who had preceded Anne and never heard of her, that something sucked his breath at night. The death certificates of fever victims of 1804, issued by Dr. Chad Hopkins, and the showing the four deceased persons all unaccountably lacking in blood, and the obscure passages of poor Roby Harris's ravings, where she complained of the sharp teeth of a glassy-eyed, half-visible presence. Free from unwarranted superstition, though I am, these things produced in me an odd sensation, which was intensified by a pair of widely separated newspaper cuttings relating to deaths in the shunned house. One from the Providence Gazette and Country, Journal of April 12, 1815, and the other from the Daily Transcript and Chronicle of October 27, 1845, each of which detailed an appallingly grisly circumstance whose duplication was remarkable. It seems that in both instances the dying person, in 1815 a gentle old lady named Stafford, and in 1845 a schoolteacher of middle age named Eleazar Durfrey, became transfigured in a horrible way, glaring glassily and attempting to bite the throat of the attending physician. Even more puzzlingly, though, was the final case which put an end to the renting of the house, a series of anemia deaths preceded by progressive madnesses wherein the patient would craftily attempt the lives of his relatives by incisions in the neck or wrist. This was in 1860 or 1861, when my uncle had just begun his medical practice, and before leaving for the front, he heard much of it from his elder professional colleagues. The really inexplicable thing was the way in which the victims, ignorant people, for the ill-smelling and widely shunned house could now be rented to no others, would babble maledictions in French, a language they could not possibly have studied to any extent. It made one think of poor Roby Harris nearly a century before, and so moved my uncle that he commenced collecting historical data on the house after listening, sometimes subsequent to his return from the war, to the first-hand account of Doctors Chase and Whitmarsh. Indeed, I could see that my uncle had thought deeply on the subject, and that he was glad of my own interest, an open-minded and sympathetic interest which enabled him to discuss with me matters at which others would merely have laughed. His fancy had not gone so far as mine, but he felt that the place was rare in its imaginative potentialities, and worthy of note as an inspiration in the field of the grotesque and macabre. For my part, I was disposed to take the whole subject with profound seriousness, and began at once not only to review the evidence, but to accumulate as much more as I could. I talked with the elderly Archer Harris, then owner of the house, many times before his death in 1916, and obtained from him and his still surviving maiden sister Alice an authentic corroboration of all the family data my uncle had collected. When, however, I asked them what connection with France or its language the house could have, they confessed themselves as frankly baffled and ignorant as I. Archer knew nothing, and all that Miss Harris could say was that an old illusion her grandfather, Duty Harris, had heard of might shed a little light. The old seaman, who had survived his son Welcome's death in battle by 2 years, had not himself known the legend, but recalled that his earliest nurse, the ancient Maria Robbins, seemed darkly aware of something that might have lent a weird significance to the French ravings of Roby Harris, which she had so often heard during the last days of that hapless woman. Maria had been at the Shunt House from 1769 till the removal of the family in 1783, and had seen Mercy Dexter die. Once she hinted to the child Duty of a somewhat peculiar circumstance in Mercy's last moments, but he had soon forgotten all about it, save it was something peculiar. The granddaughter, moreover, recalled even this much with difficulty. She and her brother were not so much interested in the house as was Archer's son Carrington, the present owner, with whom I talked after my experience. Having exhausted the Harris family of all information it could furnish, I turned my attention to early town records and deeds with a zeal more penetrating than that which my uncle had occasionally shown in the same work. What I wished was a comprehensive history of the site from its very settlement in 1636, or even before, if any Narragansett Indian legend could be unearthed so to supply the data. I found at the start that the land had been part of the long strip of home lot granted originally to John Throckmorton, one of many similar strips beginning at the town street beside the river and extending up the hill to a line roughly corresponding with the modern Hope Street. The Throckmorton lot had later, of course, been much subdivided, and I became very assiduous in tracing that section through which Back or Benefit Street was later run. It had, a rumor indeed said, been the Throckmorton graveyard. But as I examined the records more carefully, I found that the graves had all been transferred at an early date to the North Burial Ground on the Pawtucket West Road. Then suddenly I came, by a rare piece of chance, since it's not in the main body of records and might easily have been missed, upon something which aroused my keenest eagerness, fitting in as it did with several of the queerest phases of the affair. It was the record of a lease in 1697, of a small tract of ground to an Etienne Roulet and wife. At last, the French element had appeared. That, and another deeper element of horror, which the name conjured up from the darkest recesses of my weird and heterogeneous reading. And I feverishly studied the platting of the locality as it had been before the cutting through and partial straightening of Back Street between 1747 and 1758. I found what I had half expected, that where the Shunt House now stood, the Roulets had laid out their graveyard behind a one-story and attic cottage, and that no record of any transfer of graves existed. The document, indeed, ended in much confusion, and I was forced to ransack both the Rhode Island Historical Society and Shepley Library before I could find a local door which the name Etienne Roulet would unlock. In the end, I did find something. Something of such vague but monstrous import that I set about at once to examine the cellar of the Shunt House itself with a new and excited minuteness. The Roulets, it seemed, had come in 1696 from East Greenwich, down the west shore of Narragansett Bay. They were Huguenots from Caude, and had encountered much opposition before the Providence selectmen allowed them to settle in the town. Unpopularity had dogged them in East Greenwich, whither they had come in 1886, after the revocation of the Edict of Nantes, and rumor said that the cause of dislike extended beyond mere racial and national prejudice, or the land disputes which involved other French settlers with the English, in rivalries which not even Governor Andros could quell. But their ardent Protestantism, too ardent, some whispered, and their evident distress, when virtually driven from the village down the bay, had moved the sympathy of the town fathers. Here the strangers had been granted a haven, and the swarthy Etienne Roulet, less apt at agriculture than at reading queer books and drawing queer diagrams, was given a clerical post in the warehouse at Pardon Tillinghast Wharf, far south in Town Street. There had, however, been a riot of some sort later on, perhaps 40 years later, after old Relais's death, and no one seemed to hear of the family after that. For a century and more, it appeared the Relais had been well remembered and frequently discussed as vivid incidents in the quiet life of a New England seaport. Etienne's son, Paul, a surly fellow whose erratic conduct had probably provoked the riot which wiped out the family, was particularly a source of speculation. And though Providence never shared the witchcraft panics of her Puritan neighbors, it was freely intimated by old wives that his prayers were neither uttered at the proper time nor directed toward the proper object. All of this had undoubtedly formed the basis of the legend known by Old Maria Robbins. What relation it had to the French ravings of Roby Harris and other inhabitants of the shunned house, imagination or future discovery alone could determine. I wondered how many of those who had known the legends realized that additional link with the terrible which my wide reading had given me, that ominous item in the annals of morbid horror which tells of the creature Jacques Roulet of Caude, who in 1598 was condemned to death as a demonic but afterward saved from the stake by the Paris Parliament and shut in a madhouse. He had been found covered with blood and shreds of flesh in a wood shortly after the killing and rending of a boy by a pair of wolves. One wolf was seen to lope away unhurt, surely a pretty hearthside tale with a queer significance as to name and place, but I decided that the Providence gossips could not have generally known of it. Had they known, the coincidence of names would have brought some drastic and frightened action. Indeed, might not its whispering have precipitated the final riot which erased the Relais from town? I now visited the accursed place with increased frequency, studying the unwholesome vegetation of the garden, examining all the walls of the building, and poring over every inch of the earthen cellar floor. Finally, with Carrington Harris's permission, I fitted a key to the disused door opening from the cellar directly upon Benefit Street, preferring to have a more immediate access to the outside world than the dark stairs, ground floor hall, and front door could give. There, where morbidity lurked most thickly, I searched and poked during long afternoons when the sunlight filtered in through the cobwebbed above-ground windows, and a sense of security glowed from the unlocked door which placed me only a few feet from the placid sidewalk outside. Nothing new rewarded my efforts, only the same distressing mustiness and faint suggestions of noxious odors and nitrous outlines on the floor, and I fancy that many pedestrians must have watched me curiously through the broken panes. At length, upon a suggestion of my uncle's, I decided to try the spot nocturnally, and one stormy midnight ran the beams of an electric torch over the moldy floor with its uncanny shapes and distorted, half-phosphorescent fungi. The place had dispirited me curiously that evening, and I was almost prepared when I saw, or thought I saw, amidst the whitish deposits, particularly sharp definition of the huddled form I had suspected from boyhood. Its clearness was astonishing and unprecedented, and as I watched, I seemed to see again the thin, yellowish, shimmering exhalation which had startled me on that rainy afternoon so many years before. Above the anthropomorphic patch of mold by the fireplace it rose, a subtle, sickish, almost luminous vapor, which, as it hung trembling in the dampness, seemed to develop vague and shocking suggestions of form, gradually trailing off into nebulous decay and passing up into the blackness of the great chimney with a folder in its wake. It was truly horrible, and the more so to me because of what I knew of the spot. Refusing to flee, I watched it fade, and as I watched, I felt that it was in turn watching me greedily with eyes more imaginable than visible. When I told my uncle about it, he was greatly aroused, and after a tense hour of reflection, arrived at a definite and drastic decision, weighing in his mind the importance of the matter and the significance of our relationship to it, he insisted that we both test, and if possible destroy, the horror of the house by a joint night or nights of aggressive vigil in that musty and fungus-cursed cellar. On Wednesday, June 25th, 1919, with a proper notification of Carrington Harris, which did not include surmises as to what we expected to find, my uncle and I conveyed to the shunned house two camp chairs and a folding camp cot, together with some scientific mechanism of greater weight and intricacy. These were placed in the cellar during the day, screening the windows with paper and planning to return in the evening for our first vigil. We had locked the door from the cellar to the ground floor, and having a key to the outside cellar door, we were prepared to leave our expensive and delicate apparatus, which we had obtained secretly and at great cost, as many days as our vigils might need to be protracted. It was our design to sit up together till very late, and then watch singly till dawn in two-hour stretches. Myself first, then my companion, the inactive member, resting on the cot. The natural leadership with which my uncle procured the instruments from the laboratories of Brown University and the Cranston Street Armory and instinctively assumed direction of our venture was a marvelous commentary on the potential vitality and resilience of a man of 81. Elihu Whipple had lived accordingly to the hygienic laws he had preached as a physician, and, but for what happened later, would be here in full vigor today. Only two persons suspect what did happen, Carrington Harris and myself. I had to tell Harris because he owned the house and deserved to know what had gone out of it. Then, too, we had spoken to him in advance of our request, and I felt upon my uncle's going that he would understand and assist me in some vitally necessary public explanations. He turned very pale, but he agreed to help me, and decided that it would now be safe to rent the house. To declare that we were not nervous on that rainy night of watching would be an exaggeration, both gross and ridiculous. We were not, as I have said, in any sense childishly superstitious, but scientific study and the reflection had taught us that the known universe of three dimensions embraces the merest fraction of the whole cosmos of substance and energy. In this case, an overwhelming preponderance of evidence from numerous authentic sources pointed to the tenacious existence of certain forces of great power, and so far as the human point of view is concerned, exceptional malignancy. To say that we actually believed in vampires or werewolves would be a carelessly inclusive statement. Rather, must it be said that we were not prepared to deny the possibility of certain unfamiliar and unclassified modifications of vital force and attenuated matter, existing very infrequently in three-dimensional space because of its more intimate connection with other spatial units, yet close enough to the boundary of our own to furnish us occasional manifestations which we, for lack of a proper vantage point, may never hope to understand. In short, it seemed to my uncle and me that any incontrovertible array of facts pointed to some lingering influence in the shunned house, traceable to one or another of the ill-favored French settlers of two centuries before, and still operative through rare and unknown laws of atomic and electronic motion. That the family of Roulet had possessed an abnormal affinity for outer circles of entity, dark spheres, which for normal folk hold only repulsion and terror, their recorded history seemed to prove. Had not, then, the riots of those bygone 1730s set moving certain kinetic patterns in the morbid brain of one or more of them, notably the sinister Paul Roulet, which obscurely survived the bodies murdered and buried by the mob, and continued to function in some multiple-dimensioned space along the original lines of force, determined by a frantic hatred of the encroaching community, such a thing was surely not a physical or biochemical impossibility in the light of a newer science, which includes the theories of relativity and intra-atomic action. One might easily imagine an alien nucleus of substance or energy, formless or otherwise, kept alive by imperceptible or immaterial subtractions from the life force or bodily tissues and fluids of other and more palpably living things into which it penetrates, and with whose fabric it sometimes completely merges itself. It might be actively hostile, or it might be dictated merely by blind motives of self-preservation. In any such case, a monster must of necessity be in our scheme of things an anomaly and an intruder, whose extirpation forms a primary duty with every man not an enemy to the world's life, health, and sanity. What baffled us was our utter ignorance of the aspect in which we might encounter the thing. No sane person had ever seen it, and few had ever felt it definitely. It might be pure energy, a form ethereal and outside the realm of substance, or it might be partly material, some unknown and irrequivocal mass of plasticity, capable of changing at will to nebulous approximations of the solid, liquid, gaseous, or tenuously unparticled states. The anthropomorphic patch of mold on the floor, the form of the yellow vapor, and the curvature of the tree roots in some of the old tales, all argued at least a remote and reminiscent connection with the human shape. But how representative or permanent that similarity might be, none could say with any kind of certainty. We had devised two weapons to fight it. A large and specially fitted Crookes tube operated by powerful storage batteries and provided with peculiar screens and reflectors in case it proved intangible and opposable only by vigorously destructive ether radiations, and a pair of military flamethrowers of the sort used in the World War in case it proved partially material and susceptible of mechanical destruction. For like the superstitious Exeter rustics, we were prepared to burn the thing's heart out if heart existed to burn. All this aggressive mechanism we set in the cellar in positions carefully arranged with reference to the cot and chairs, and to the spot before the fireplace where the mold had taken strange shapes. That suggestive patch, by the way, was only faintly visible when we placed our furniture and instruments, and when we returned that evening for the actual vigil. For a moment, I have doubted that I ever even seen it in a more definitely limned form, but then I thought of the legends. Our cellar vigil began at 10 p.m., daylight saving time, and as it continued, we found no promise of pertinent developments. A weak, filtered glow from the rain-harassed street lamps outside, and a feeble phosphorescence from the detestable fungi within, showed the dripping stone of the walls, from which all traces of whitewash had vanished. The dank, foated, and mildew-tainted hard earth floor with its obscene fungi, the rotting remains of what had been stools, chairs, and tables, and other more shapeless furniture, the heavy planks and massive beams of the ground floor overhead, the decrepit plank door leading to bins and chambers beneath other parts of the house, the crumbling stone staircase with ruined wood handrail, and the crude and cavernous fireplace of blackened brick, where rusted iron fragments revealed the past presence of hooks and irons, spit, crane, and a door to the Dutch oven. These things, and our austere cot and camp chairs, and the heavy and intricate destructive machinery we had brought. We had, as in my own former explorations, left the door to the street unlocked, so that a direct and practical path of escape might lie open in case of manifestations beyond our power to deal with. It was our idea that our continued nocturnal presence would call forth whatever malign entity lurked there, and that being prepared, we could dispose of the thing with one or the other of our provided means as soon as we had recognized and observed it sufficiently. How long it might require to evoke and extinguish the thing, we had no notion. It occurred to us, too, that our venture was far from safe, for in what strength that thing might appear, no one could tell. But we deemed the game worth the hazard, and embarked on it alone and unhesitatingly, conscious that the seeking of the outside aid would only expose us to ridicule and perhaps defeat our entire purpose. Such was our frame of mind as we talked far into the night, till my uncle's growing drowsiness made me remind him to lie down for his 2-hour sleep. Something like fear chilled me as I sat there in the small hours, alone. I say alone, for one who sits by a sleeper is indeed alone, perhaps more alone than he can realize. My uncle breathed heavily, his deep inhalations and exhalations accompanied by the rain outside, and punctuated by another nerve-wracking sound of distant dripping water within. For the house was repulsively damp, even in dry weather, and in this storm, positively swamp-like. I studied the loose antique masonry of the walls and the fungus. Light and the feeble rays which stole in from the street through the screened windows, and once, when the noisome atmosphere of the place seemed about to sicken me, I opened the door and looked up and down the street, feasting my eyes on familiar sights, and my nostrils on the wholesome air. Still nothing occurred to reward my watching, and I yawned repeatedly, fatigue getting the better of apprehension. Then the stirring of my uncle in his sleep attracted my notice. He had turned restlessly on the cot several times during the latter half of the first hour, but now he was breathing with unusual irregularity, occasionally heaving a sigh which held more than a few of the qualities of a choking moan. I turned my electric flashlight on him and found his face averted, so rising and crossing to the other side of the cot, I again flashed the light to see if he seemed in any pain. What I saw unnerved me most surprisingly, considering its relative triviality. It must have been merely the association of any odd circumstance with the sinister nature of our location and mission, for surely the circumstance was not in itself frightful or unnatural. It was merely that my uncle's facial expression, disturbed, no doubt, by the strange dreams which our situation prompted, betrayed considerable agitation and seemed not at all characteristic of him. His habitual expression was one of kindly and well-bred calm, whereas now a variety of emotions seemed struggling within him. I think, on the whole, that it was this variety which chiefly disturbed me. My uncle, as he gasped and tossed in increasing perturbation, and with eyes that now started open, seemed not one but many men, and suggested a curious quality of alienage from himself. All at once, he commenced to mutter, and I did not like the look of his mouth and teeth as he spoke. The words were at first indistinguishable, and then, with a tremendous start, I recognized something about them which filled me with icy fear till I recalled the breadth of my uncle's education and the interminable translations he had made from anthropological and antiquarian articles in the Rêves de Dumont. For the venerable Eli Whipple was muttering in French, and the few phrases I could distinguish seemed connected with the darkest myths he had ever adapted from the famous Paris magazine. Suddenly a perspiration broke out on the sleeper's forehead, and he leaped abruptly up, half awake. The jumble of French changed to a cry in English, and the hoarse voice shouted excitedly, "My breath! My breath!" Then the awakening became complete, and with a subsidence of facial expression to the normal state, my uncle seized my hand and began to relate a dream whose nucleus of significance I could only surmise with a kind of awe. He had, he said, floated off from a very ordinary series of dream pictures into a scene whose strangeness was related to nothing he had ever read. It was of this world, and yet not of it. A shadowy geometrical confusion in which he could be seen elements of familiar things in most unfamiliar and perturbing combinations. There was a suggestion of queerly disordered pictures superimposed one upon another, an arrangement in which the essentials of time as well as of space seemed dissolved and mixed in the most illogical fashion. In this kaleidoscope vortex of phantasmal images were occasional snapshots, if one might use the term, of singular clearness, but unaccountable heterogeneity. Once my uncle thought he lay in a carelessly dug open pit, with a crowd of angry faces framed by straggling locks and three-cornered hats frowning down on him. Again he seemed to be in the interior of a house, an old house apparently, but the details and inhabitants were constantly changing, and he could never be certain of the faces or the furniture, or even of the room itself, since doors and windows seemed in just as great a state of flux as the more presumably mobile objects. It was queer, damnably clear,
and my uncle spoke almost sheepishly, as if half expecting not to be believed, when he declared that of the strange faces, many had unmistakably borne the features of the Harris family. And all the while, there was a personal sensation of choking, as if some pervasive presence had spread itself through his body and sought to possess itself of his vital processes. I shuddered at the thought of those vital processes, worn as they were by 81 years of continuous functioning, in conflict with unknown forces of which the youngest and the strongest system might well be afraid. But in another moment reflected that dreams are only dreams, and that these uncomfortable visions could be, at most, no more than my uncle's reaction to the investigations and expectations which had lately filled our minds to the exclusion of all else. Conversation also soon tended to dispel my sense of strangeness, and in time I yielded to my yawns and took my turn at slumber. My uncle seemed now very wakeful, and welcomed his period of watching, even though the nightmare had aroused him far ahead of his allotted 2 hours. Sleep seized me quickly, and I was at once haunted with dreams of the most disturbing kind. I felt in my visions a cosmic and abysmal loneness, with hostility surging from all sides upon some prison where I lay confined. I seemed bound and gagged, and taunted by the echoing yells of distant multitudes who thirsted for my blood. My uncle's face came to me with less pleasant associations than in waking hours, and I recall many futile struggles and attempts to scream. It was not a pleasant sleep, and for a second I was not sorry for the echoing shriek which clove through the barriers of dream and flung me to a sharp and startled awakeness in which every actual object before my eyes stood out with more than natural clearness and reality. I had been lying with my face away from my uncle's chair, so that in this sudden flash of awakening, I saw only the door to the street, the more northerly window, and the wall and floor and ceiling toward the north of the room, all photographed with morbid vividness on my brain, in a light brighter than the glow of the fungi or the rays from the street outside. It was not a strong or even fairly strong light, certainly not nearly strong enough to read an average book by, but it cast a shadow of myself and the cot on the floor, and had a yellowish, penetrating force that hinted at things more potent than luminosity. This I perceived with unhealthy sharpness, despite the fact that two of my other senses were violently assailed. For on my ears rang the reverberations of that shocking scream, while my nostrils revolted at the stench which filled the place. My mind, as alert as my senses, recognized the gravely unusual, and almost automatically I leapt up and turned about to grasp the destructive instruments which we had left trained on the moldy spot before the fireplace. As I turned, I dreaded what I was to see, for the scream had been in my uncle's voice, and I knew not against what menace I should have to defend him and myself. Yet after all, the sight was worse than I had dreaded. There were horrors beyond horrors, and this was one of those nuclei of all dreamable hideousness which the cosmos saves to blast an accursed and unhappy few. Out of the fungus-ridden earth steamed up a vaporous corpse-light, yellow and deceased, which bubbled and lapped to a gigantic height in vague outlines half-human and half-monstrous, through which I could see the chimney and fireplace beyond. It was all eyes, wolfish and mocking, and the rugose insect-like head dissolved at the top to a thin stream of mist, which curled putridly about, and finally vanished up the chimney. I say I saw this thing, but it is only in conscious retrospection that I ever definitely traced its damnable approach to form. At the time, it was to me only a seething, dimly phosphorescent cloud of fungus loathsomeness, enveloping and dissolving to an abhorrent plasticity the one object to which all my attention was focused. That object was my uncle, the venerable Elihu Whipple, who, with blackening and decaying features, leered and gibbered at me and reached out
dripping claws to rend me in the fury which this horror had brought. It was a sense of routine which kept me from going mad. I had drilled myself in preparation for the crucial moment, and blind training saved me. Recognizing the bubbling evil as no substance reachable by matter or material chemistry, and therefore ignoring the flamethrower which loomed on my left, I threw on the current of Crookes tube apparatus and focused toward that scene of immortal blasphemousness, the strongest ether radiations which man's art can arouse from the spaces and fluids of nature. There was a bluish haze and a frenzied sputtering, and the yellowish phosphorescence grew dimmer to my eyes. But I saw the dimness was only that of contrast, and that the waves from the machine had no effect whatever. Then, in the midst of that demonic spectacle, I saw a fresh horror which brought cries to my lips and sent me fumbling and staggering toward that unlocked door to the quiet street, careless of what abnormal terrors I loosed on the world, or what thoughts or judgments of men I brought down upon my head. In that dim blend of blue and yellow, the form of my uncle had commenced a nauseous liquefaction whose essence eludes all description, and in which there played across his vanishing face such changes of identity as only madness can conceive. He was at once a devil and a multitude, a charnel house and a pageant. Lit by the mixed and uncertain beams, that gelatinous face assumed a dozen, a score, a hundred aspects, grinning as it sank to the ground on a body that melted like tallow, in a caricatured likeness of legions strange and yet not strange. I saw the features of the Harris line, masculine and feminine, adult and infantile, and other features, old and young, coarse and refined, familiar and unfamiliar. For a second, there flashed a degraded counterfeit of a miniature of poor mad Roby Harris that I had seen in the School of Design Museum. And another time I thought I saw the raw-boned imagery of Mercy Dexter as I recalled her from a painting in Carrington Harris's house. It was frightful beyond conception. Toward the last, when a curious blend of servant and baby visages flickered close to the fungus floor where a pool of greenish grease was spreading, it seemed as though the shifting features fought against themselves and strode to form contours like those of my uncle's kindly face. I like to think that he existed at that moment, and that he tried to bid me farewell. It seems to me that I hiccuped a farewell from my own parched throat as I lurched out into the street, a thin stream of grease following me through the door to the rain-drenched sidewalk. The rest is shadowy and monstrous. There was no one in the soaking street, and in all the world there was no one I dared tell. I walked aimlessly south past College Hill and the Anatheum, down Hopkins Street and over the bridge to the business section, where tall buildings seemed to guard me as modern material things guard the world from ancient and unwholesome wonder. Then gray dawn unfolded wetly from the east, silhouetting the archaic hill and its venerable steeples and beckoning me to the place where my terrible work was still unfinished. And in the end I went, wet, hatless, and dazed in the morning light, and entered that awful door in Benefit Street, which I had left ajar, and which still swung cryptically in full sight of the early householders, to whom I dared not speak. The grease was gone, for the moldy floor was porous, and in front of the fireplace was no vestige of the giant doubled-up form of nitre. I looked at the cot, the chairs, the instruments, my neglected hat, and the yellow straw hat of my uncle. Dazedness was uppermost, and I could scarcely recall what was dream and what was reality. Then thought trickled back, and I knew that I had witnessed things more horrible than I had dreamed. Sitting down, I tried to conjecture, nearly as sanity would let me, just what had happened, and how I might end the horror, if indeed it had been real. Matter it seemed not to be, nor ether, nor anything else conceivable by mortal mind. What, then, but some exotic
emanation, some vampirish vapor, such as Exeter rustics tell of, is lurking over certain churchyards? This I felt was the clue, and again I looked at the floor before the fireplace where the mold and the night air had taken strange forms. In 10 minutes, my mind was made up. Taking my hat, I set out for home, where I bathed, ate, and gave by telephone an order for a pickaxe, a spade, a military gas mask, and 6 carboys of sulfuric acid, all to be delivered the next morning at the cellar door of the shunned house in Benefit Street. After that, I tried to sleep, and failing, passed the hours in reading and in composition of inane verses to counteract my mood. At 11 a.m., the next day, I commenced digging. It was sunny weather, and I was glad of that. I was still alone, for as much as I feared the unknown horror I sought, there was more fear in the thought of telling anybody. Later, I told Harris only through sheer necessity, and because he had heard odd tales from old people which disposed him ever so little toward belief. As I turned up the stinking black earth in front of the fireplace, my spade, causing a viscous yellow ichor to ooze from the white fungi which it severed, I trembled at the dubious thoughts of what I might uncover. Some secrets of inner earth are not good for mankind, and this seemed to me one of them. My hand shook perceptibly, but I still delved. After a while, standing in the large hole I had made, with the deepening of the hole, which was about 6 feet square, the evil smell increased, and I lost all doubt of my intimate contact with the hellish thing whose emanations had cursed the house for over a century and a half. I wondered what it would look like, what its form and substance would be, and how big it might have waxed through long ages of life-sucking. Then arranging the great carboys of acid around and near 2 sides, so that when necessary I might empty them all down the aperture in quick succession. After that I dumped earth only along the other 2 sides, working more slowly, and donning my gas mask as the smell grew. I was nearly unnerved at my proximity to a nameless thing at the bottom of the pit. Suddenly my spade struck something softer than earth. I shuddered, and made a motion as if to climb out of the hole, which was now as deep as my neck. Then courage returned, and I scraped away more dirt in the light of the electric torch I had provided. The surface I uncovered was fishy and glassy, a kind of semi-putrid congealed jelly with suggestions of translucency. I scraped further and saw that it had form. There was a rift where a part of the substance was folded over. The exposed area was huge and roughly cylindrical, like a mammoth soft blue-white stovepipe, doubled in 2, its largest part some 2 feet in diameter. Still more I scraped, and then abruptly I leaped out of the hole and away from that filthy thing, frantically unstopping and tilting the heavy carboys and precipitating the corrosive contents one after another down that carnal gulf and upon the unthinkable abnormality whose titan elbow I had seen. The blinding maelstrom of greenish-yellow vapor, which surged tempestuously up from that hole as the floods of acid descended, will never leave my memory. All along the hill, people tell of the yellow day when virulent and horrible fumes arose from the factory waste dumped in the Providence River. But I know how mistaken they are as to the source. They tell, too, of the hideous roar which at the same time came from some disordered water pipe or gas main underground. But again, I could correct them if I dared. It was unspeakably shocking, and I did not see how I lived through it. I did faint after emptying the 4th carboy, which I had to handle after the fumes had begun to penetrate my mask. But when I recovered, I saw that the hole was emanating no fresh vapors. The 2 remaining carboys I emptied down without particular result. And after a time, I felt it safe to shovel the earth back into the pit. It was twilight before I was done, but fear had gone out of that place. The dampness was less foetid, and all the strange fungi had withered to a kind of harmless grayish powder which blew ash-like along the floor. One of the earth's nethermost terrors had perished forever, and if there be hell, It had received, at last, the demon soul of an unhallowed thing. And as I patted down the last spadeful of mold, I shed the first of the many tears with which I have paid unaffected tribute to my beloved uncle's memory. The next spring, no more pale grass and strange weeds came up in the shunned house terraced gardens, and shortly afterward, Carrington Harris rented the place. It is still spectral, but its strangeness fascinates me. And I shall find mixed with my relief a queer regret when it's torn down to make way for a tawdry shop or vulgar apartment building. The barren old trees in the yard have begun to bear small, sweet apples, and last year the birds nestled in their gnarled boughs.
Thanks for listening. The story you've just heard in this channel are fan-funded. Visit ChillingTalesForDarkNights.com today to become a patron and help us bring radio theater back from the dead. Just click Support Us, choose an amount you're comfortable with, and become a part of our family today. Just $2 per month gets you immediate access to our patrons area. There, you'll find advanced new releases, our incredible archive of over 300 hours of productions, plus never-before-heard bonus material. Best of all, it's totally ad-free and in HD MP3 format. You get insider updates from our production team, the secret stash of streaming downloadable HD indie films, and you get to experience our patrons-only one-on-one live events, putting you up close and personal with your favorite performers, unscripted and unrehearsed. All of this and more is yours today, and all you have to do is choose your level of support. Go to ChillingTalesForDarkNights.com now and join us as we turn off the lights and turn on the dark.